There's a reason that we live so far from Hollywood. In the country, looking hard to find a home. We're nothing perfect or considered, but we're so damn good. It's the story of your life. You're moving.
Morning, Gloria, America. Bonjour, hi, Canada. From the IEL waste on the western borders, I'm Hugh Hewitt. I've removed to winter quarters. Thanks to Ed Morrissey, who sat in for me yesterday. Did a wonderful job. I think there was some Steelers talk, so we have to air the place out and open the windows and fumigate. But I'm back to the IEL waste for a good many months. There is a time to be inside the Beltway, and there's a time to flee the Beltway. This is a time to flee the Beltway. Dutifully, as I fled yesterday, the Beltway, I took with me Ken Follett's new novel, Never. I cannot recommend this book highly enough because it may be the second major novel about how the Chinese government works. The first being 2034, but that's a narrow look inside the CCP, the Chinese Communist Party, and a broader scope, Admiral Stav Reedus and Elliot Ackerman, on how the military works at sea in the CCP. What Ken Follett's book Never does is take you inside how the Chinese Communist Party works in 2021, soon to be 2022. And I cannot emphasize enough how we've needed books like this. Most of the West learned how Moscow worked, not from going to college and taking Stanley Hoffman or Henry Kissinger or anyone else who was talking about how the Soviets worked. And most of what they thought was wrong, where they read the long telegram by Mr. X, who turned out to be George Kennan early on in the Cold War. No, they weren't Nixon. They weren't studying the briefing papers. They weren't Jimmy Carter, who had an inordinate fear of communism. None of that, all those years of the Cold War, that's not how people learned in America. They read Time, Newsweek, and U.S. News and World Report, and they would routinely report on what was going on, or so they thought, or so correspondents in Moscow thought. And now people have watched the Americans, and they get a view of how sleepers worked, which isn't right. That's not how sleepers worked in the United States. They had lots of spies in the 1980s. That was one of my earliest jobs. If you're listening to Hugh Hewitt for the first time, I'm going to give you the quick bio in a second, but after the wall came down and the Soviet Union crumbled, people sort of put their communism studies away, thinking, oh, well, the Chinese are simply evolving to a market capitalism society and we will help them get there and everything will be comfy, hunky-dory in the world. Bill Clinton let them into the world of free trade. We accepted them into the world's institutions. And in fact, they're still Leninists. And the country's difficult to understand. It's so big, it's so numerous, it's 1.3 billion people, and it's so opaque that very few novelists have dared to try and describe how the country works. Your New Year's resolution ought to be to read Never, which is a fine, I mean, it's a rollicking good novel. It's a great read. Ken Follett never disappoints. Ken Follett came to this, to the IEL Wasteland studio many, many years ago. And if you don't know what the IEL Wasteland is, that means you haven't read The Wheel of Time. And if you haven't read The Wheel of Time, and you haven't, even if you've watched the first series of The Wheel of Time, which will go on, I think, for 30 years, I don't think you get to the IEL Wasteland until season 3 or 4. I don't know how they're writing it, but the IEL Wasteland is basically my studio in the West. And it's where you learn how to do radio, in the IEL Wasteland. In any event, Follett came down to the IEL Wasteland a few years ago, and we had a great, rollicking 3-hour conversation. I'm going to ask Harley to post that over today as the last interview of the year. And so Ken Follett is he's a genius at narrative. He tells good stories. Good stories make for great novels. And he ranges all over the human canvas, and now he's ranged to the present day, and he's ranged to China and to Africa and to America. And in China, he's actually, I am hardly a sinologist, but I know a lot of people who stayed at a Holiday Inn and speak Mandarin. I know O'Brien and Pompeo, you know, Secretary of State Pompeo, there are about 25 people running for president. And the two people who are most knowledgeable about the Soviet Union are Mike Pompeo and Robert O'Brien. Behind them is Matt Pottinger, Mary Kissel. There are a lot of people who know about the Soviet Union. I mean, about the Chinese Communist Party and the People's Republic of China. The one who knows the most who is running for president is Mike Pompeo. The one who knows the most who is in the Congress is Tom Cotton. So I think if China becomes the menace in people's mind that I suspect it will over the next 2 years, because they've unleashed this virus, which is everywhere and killing everyone and doing terrible things. It's not going to kill you if you've had your vaccines and your booster shot. You wear your mask on an airplane. If you do normal things, it's not going to kill you. If your children get it, it's very, very unlikely. Your children are much more likely to get hit by a car playing in the street than they are to die of COVID. They're much more likely to have a rare form of the terrible cancer. And lots of kids get sick, and it's very terrible. And I've been to the Children's Hospital here in Southern California often enough. There are two great ones in L.A. and Orange County to know how sad it is, how terrible it is, how awful it is to have a child who's genuinely deeply sick. But it's very, very unlikely that it's going to be COVID that puts them there. So the Chinese did this to the world, and they don't care. They don't have a regretful bone in their body. And the Middle Kingdom thinks that they got screwed by the West for 200 years. And by the way, they did. They got screwed by the West for 200 years. And so they are about becoming the most powerful country in the world and issuing orders to the rest of the world. Dr. Kissinger himself told me they will never invade another country for the purposes of occupying it. They do invade when they need to, like Vietnam, they invaded in 79 or 80, I can't remember. And they took over Tibet because they thought it was theirs, and they're going to kill everyone in Xinjiang until they get rid of their Muslim problem. And they'll exploit Afghanistan, and they'll push the Russians back. Eventually, they'll push the Russians around. And they'll take over some islands, and they'll lay pressure on Japan, and they'll try and prop up North Korea. We know what they're going to do. Ken Follett explains how they do it and how we are now in a second Cold War and how it is very, very dangerous. So my reading yesterday was not news. There is no news. You know, I have here one article. U.S. hit with record number of new COVID-19 cases. One article, Wall Street Journal. And I have an invitation for you to call 1-800-520-1234. It's the last live show of the year. Tomorrow, December 31st, we play Dr. Larry Arnes of Hillsdale College, his part one of the March Through the History of Ideas, which we've been playing for years. And then on Monday, we play part two, and then we begin the new year. There will be some news by January the 3rd. But this is the year where we actually don't have a block list. It's Festivus on the radio. You can call and complain about anything, and you can get through. 1-800-520-1234. Even if you're drunk like you normally are, and we put you on the list that you can't get through, I'll let you through.
Nutty callers of the world, unite.
Unite. You're allowed
in. This is your day.
This is your day. Now, we might cut you off if you break an FCC rule, and we have a six-second delay, so that those of you who are intemperate of speech or slurred of speech, we can get rid of you. But if you want to call up and insult Dwayne, I won't stop you. I'm normally his shield and his sword to protect Dwayne. But if I had a producer, they would say, don't do this. But Dwayne doesn't care. He said, that's a good idea. Anyone who wants to can call. You can do whatever you want today. It's Caller Day, an annual tradition on the Hugh Hewitt Show. I normally run a very tight show, and I don't take that many callers. I take 4 or 5 callers a day.
This is the closest we will ever sound to Mike Gallagher's show.
Right, right. We're doing Mike's show today.
We're doing Mike's show today.
And we love Mike, but Mike does talk randomly with everybody. And so, you know, I see Randy in Columbus is calling in. 1-800-520-1234. I want to remind you, year-end donations, two things. You can go to HughHewitt.com and give to Prison Fellowship at the bar at the very top. And they really do deserve your help. They do that part of the gospel where you know, maybe you've taken care of the poor. Maybe you've fed the hungry. Maybe you've clothed the naked. Maybe you visited the widow and orphan. And you haven't done anything about anyone in prison. And Jesus said, they count too. Don't forget them. Well, a donation to Prison Fellowship checks that off. So when you meet your maker, he says, yep, check, check, check. I, I never met you. Yeah, you did. When you did this to me, you did it for all of me, the least of these. That's your prison fellowship donation. I'm also going to suggest I'd like 100% participation of everyone on this show to go to hillsdale.edu and make a donation. I'm going to do that this morning myself. Why? Because they're the lantern in the north, friends. We are down to it. We are really down to it. We got to keep Hillsdale's flame. They're the flame of Tarvalin, even as I'm in the IEL West, the wasteland. 1-800-520-1234. Your phone calls are open on caller day, December 30th, 2021, here on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Carol Platt-Liebau for townhall.com. China has built the largest DNA database in the world, and it's only growing. This should concern all of us. That's because China could use this information in the future, perhaps, for example, to build bioweapons targeting specific ethnic groups. Given this background, common sense dictates that Americans shouldn't be storing their DNA or other personal information with Chinese-linked firms. Quite sensibly, after getting an FBI briefing about the firm's connections to China, the Los Angeles County Sheriff notified the county that his office wouldn't work with Fulgent. That's the genetics firm LA County hired for mandatory COVID testing and registration. Fulgent even admits in a public disclaimer it stores information outside the United States, where data privacy protections may not be as secure. I'll bet. What's alarming is how many others have chosen to work with Fulgent. The question is why.
publicpolicy.pepperdine.edu. Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
You talked about the pandemic being one of fear yesterday, which I thought was very wise. And I wonder, you talk about male-female issues quite a bit. I wonder if you thought that the prevalence of women in media and in government might have something to do with our pandemic of fear.
The prevalence of women in teaching has to do with it. I don't think the CDC and NIH are predominantly a female. Teaching profession is. The disgrace of teachers screwing kids' lives like they did the last year and a half. We're not going to teach. We may get COVID. Sweden never closed its schools for kids under 16. Never.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
As you know, the governor wants kids your age between 5 to 11 to get vaccinated. Have you been vaccinated?
No, not yet.
Mm-hmm. Is your school going to require you to get vaccinated?
I think I might have heard some things about San Juan Unified, which is a district I go to.
Mm-hmm.
It's probably going to require vaccines soon.
I think you're right, and I don't think it matters whether you're at a public school as you are or a private school. I believe that the governor said as soon as the FDA approved the vaccine for children your age, he was going to require it. He's postponed it. It was supposed to go into effect, I think, in January or February, but he's postponed it. But as far as I know, Alton is still going to go into effect. How do you
keep up with what's trending? Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
This is a story of how a million children were placed with local foster families through an unlikely alliance between the Chinese government and a British footballer. Parents from all walks of life share their stories of overcoming the one-child policy by taking in orphans. With unprecedented access across the country, this is a unique insight into the lives of the 90s orphans now driving the 21st century's fastest growing economy.
This story needs to be told across the world. At a time where there's so much negativity and cynicism, here's proof that a single leap of faith can change the world.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
This is Carol Platt-Lebow for townhall.com.
Oh my, oh my. Good morning, America. The alarmists are saying the country's going to shut down because of Omicron. Yeah, I just don't think so. I think Omicron is pretty bad and it's everywhere. And I think everyone's probably going to get it. And if exponential growth is exponential growth, and eventually everyone's going to be exposed. Now, if you've had the vaccines and the boosters I have, you might get the sniffles. I haven't had it yet. You might get the sniffles and go down. There are breakout cases everywhere, but you won't. You won't be out for more than a couple of days. And we'll manage. The country's not, you know, dark winter, forget it, not happening. Now, I wouldn't want to be in a country that was using the Chinese Communist Party's vaccine, which is, I think, you know, soybean and dust, but they're going to be overrun. And I loved it yesterday. The commies put out, they have 8 cases of Omicron. Yeah, we can believe them, you bet. All right, let's get to this. Randy in Columbus, welcome. It's Caller's Day at the end of 2021.
Hugh, I love you, man. You rock, okay?
Uh-oh.
I respect you to 110%, man.
All right.
You know, you're gonna hear this. I listen to you every day. I just shake my head yes on everything you say. But I just got one question I want to put past you. I've heard in the past that whenever someone calls in to talk about the election, you shut them down and you cut them off real quick. And I would really appreciate it if I could just bring a couple points across.
You can. It's Caller's Day, but if you go into the far reaches of election lunacy and you get me sued by someone, I'm not going to let you do that because there wasn't any fraud in the voting machines and there wasn't any there hasn't been any evidence. Okay, go ahead, Randy. I don't want you to slander anybody. I won't let anyone slander anybody.
No, I won't. Well, how did you go into an election? I forget which state it was when Trump was up 300,000 or 400,000 votes. What state was that? And then they had to shut stuff down. They had to shut the counting down.
That didn't
for like
happen.
4 hours.
That didn't happen.
Okay. What about this? 11 million more people voted for Trump this go around than in 2016.
That's true.
And still lost.
And that's because
and
you know,
still
I, lost. I talked to the president about that. President Trump. I talked to him about that. Donald Trump was uniquely energizing figure on both sides of the American political spectrum. Joe Biden didn't win. Donald Trump turned out an incredible number of people. 11 million more than had previously voted for him showed up, but far more Democrats than new Republicans. New Democrats rather than new Republicans showed up. It was the biggest turnout we've had in years, and I don't know that we'll ever get back to that level, but he energized the GOP, but he also energized the Democrats.
Okay, so do you think that Biden won fairly?
Yes, 100%.
Wow.
Do you know who else I told that to? I told that to the president in the Oval Office in December.
Man, I've had more people in my backyard in a barbecue than Biden had at his rallies.
Well, that's true. I don't think it was about voting in Biden.
They kept him in the basement.
I know. It wasn't about voting for Biden. It was a referendum on Trump. And I wish people would understand. Biden's got nothing to do with it. They could have put up the scarecrow from The Wizard of Oz, and he would have won.
Oh, absolutely.
Okay, well, I get that. They kind of did,
actually.
We saw how he handled Afghanistan.
Yeah, and I pray for the president every day, and I encourage everyone to do so, because I think it's going to be a very rough 3 years. I think Putin, who's an evil man. For some reason, Terry Moran over at ABC. Dwayne, do you remember Terry when I came up? Did I do something bad to Terry Moran?
I don't think so.
Accusing me of loving Putin for some reason.
No, I think what happened with Terry Moran is that was one of your interviews where he kind of said some things on an interview that when it went around everywhere, he got an immense amount of blowback from the left about that and media types about that.
Oh, okay. Because I was on a plane yesterday for 100 hours to get to the IEO waste. And I get off the plane and I see that Terry Moran is accusing me of liking Putin.
I don't know where he gets that from.
I mean, I hate Putin. Putin is an evil dictator. He's a very ruthless, effective evil dictator, but he's an evil dictator. So I thought, did I run over a dog? What happened? This is one of the strange things about Twitter is random hostility breaks out. And sometimes I think people are just drinking too much during Christmas. All right, we got a full board, 1-800-520-1234. Ralph and Robert and John and whoever else calls. Dwayne can't get the feed to work. Dwayne's having a mental breakdown. We'll come right back. Don't go anywhere.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Birch Gold Group.
This is Carol Platt-Lebow for townhall.com. Sometimes there are policies so destructive that at first you don't believe they're true. Joe Biden is currently defending one, his plan to award $450,000 to migrants separated from their families after entering the U.S. illegally. Children of deceased U.S. soldiers are separated from their parents permanently. They don't receive this kind of money. And migrants who enter the U.S. legally certainly don't get this kind of payout. The really big jackpot, it seems, is being reserved for the lawbreakers. There are some obvious truths here. First, behavior that's subsidized gets repeated. Joe Biden is effectively inviting many more illegal immigrants to breach America's open borders. Second, he's betting over time the payoffs will benefit his party in political terms. Meanwhile, the vast majority of Americans watch in shock and dismay as our president, the country's chief law enforcement officer, brazenly rewards lawbreaking, a clear violation of his oath to defend our nation's laws. It's a sorry sight indeed.
Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
If he was disappointed, and to explain why he was not able to sell a member of his own party, Joe Manchin, on the idea of Build Back Better, why this was not important for the American people. In cut number 9, Biden says, hey, it's not over yet. He seemed optimistic that there was still hope that he could bring Joe Manchin around. Cut number 9.
You've met with Senator Joe Manchin a number of times. You invited him to your home in Delaware. He came to the White House a week ago. Then he's on Sunday morning cable and says, I'm a no. How does that happen? How are you not able to close the deal?
Well, look, let's talk about what we have done. We have passed more major legislation than anybody in their first year ever, 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 ever. I haven't given up on this. I haven't given up on it.
But Senator Manchin's main sticking point, it would appear, is the child tax credit. Are you willing to take that out if it means bringing him on board?
Well, look, I want to get as much as I can possibly get done, as much as we can possibly get done. I still think we'll be able to get a significant amount of what we need to get done, particularly as the American people figure out what is in this legislation.
Well, isn't that part of the problem, that the American people kind of know what's in this 2,000-page spending bill? Isn't that the problem, Mr. President? We do know what's in there. That's why we do not support it. That's why your approval rating hit an all-time low this week, around 41%. The American people know what's in that spending plan, and they simply don't want it. Joe Manchin knows that the people of West Virginia can't afford what you're trying to sell.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
The Democratic Party somehow has convinced black people that they're the good guys, never mind the skanky history of the Democratic Party. That was a party of slavery. There is a whole big cottage industry for racism. If racism went away, a lot of people would be unemployed.
The mob during the Minneapolis riots following the death of George Floyd, a bunch of white thugs, frankly, burning down the city's traditional black and Asian business district.
They're racist, racist, racist. Everything's racist.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
how a million children were placed with local foster families. Parents from all walks of life share their stories of overcoming the one-child policy by taking in orphans.
Go to salemnow.com. Streaming on Salem Now.
We'll see one young lady identify as transgender, and the next thing you know, six or seven young ladies in that same school are now identifying as transgender.
Children taught at age five, they can create their gender identity, and it's being celebrated.
Schools are lining up to push the transgender agenda on kids and cut parents out of the equation.
Every cell of their body that has a nucleus is male or female.
We've now seen parents losing custody of their children if they don't go along with this.
We've all been created XY or XX, so that means there's only two genders. And so really the battle is against the creator.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
The most powerful organs of the state are not merely corrupt, but that they've been weaponized.
We are now all rooting for his success.
That's not what happened.
It was a complete ambush.
I thought it's early enough. Let's just send a couple guys over.
And the audience was, ha, 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 ha. How funny to set up an innocent man.
It divided the country in ways that people can't imagine. It's inspired massive violence.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Back, America. It's Hugh Hewitt. We've got the feed working again in the IEL waste that is the western winter quarters. We're on the western border of the IEL waste here for the winter. I leave the Beltway in January and February, sometimes March, because nobody wants to be there. They have to be there, and sometimes they legislate, but nobody really wants to be there. I am happy to take your calls from anyone. It's Caller to Amnesty Day. So Tim in Moore Park, who's been on our block list forever. Hello, Tim.
Callum Kerrion, U.S. President, best major candidate, K-A-L-E-M-K-A-R-I-A-N. My platform is love, peace, joy, truth, freedom, and self-control.
So if the self-control part is, why do you call the show every day?
Because I want to be president.
Well, I know, but that's...
best major candidate.
You know, if you went down and worked with the homeless, or if you did ladled soup at the soup kitchen, you'd do a lot of good for people.
I can do a lot better job than Biden is for the homeless.
Well, that might be the case, but you actually could use your day to benefit other people. What do you do for a living, Tim?
He runs for office.
Candidate.
I know, but...
I'm U.S. president.
But don't you want to actually change lives and do something productive?
I'm going to change lives when I'm president.
All right. God bless you, Tim. Happy New Year.
Can I tell a quick story for the audience about Tim?
Absolutely.
1995 is when I first started doing radio, and we did a remote for a Christian broadcaster that I did. Tim showed up to this event and stood on the corner wearing an old-fashioned sandwich sign, ringing a bell saying, Tim for President, Senate, Congress, Mayor, dog catcher, everything he was running for. And he sat there for 3 hours trying to run for office back in 95.
That's how long he's been doing this. That's why we have a list in the studio, people. It's like Santa's beard. If you get on that list, you don't get through. Let me do a pre-market
unless
update.
It's the last day
unless
of the year.
Unless it's the last day of the year, last live broadcast day of the year. Birch Gold is a great sponsor of this show. I love Birch Gold. I buy my gold from Birch Gold. And if you are rolling over, if you're buying gold of any sort and any amount, You can go to hughgold.com or text my name, H-U-G-H, to 989898, and I'll be back to you with free information. Their very best thing is that they take 5 or 10% of your retirement. So if you've got $1 million put away, they'll put $100,000 into gold bullion and silver, and they'll put it in a depository, they'll put your name on it, and they'll maintain it. And the IRS lets that be a 401k. You can't do that at home in a shoebox. You'll be taxed. You need a third-party trustee, and that's what Birch Gold does. And they do it very, very well. To reach them, you go to hughgold.com or you text my name, Hugh, to 474747. And they sponsor the market update. Yesterday, the Dow was up a little bit. The S&P was up a little bit. The NASDAQ was down 0.1%. Overseas this morning, it's mixed. Again, nobody goes to work this week. This is the law. That's why I retreat to the IEL wasteland this week. Nobody noticed. Everybody flies. Boy, was the airports jammed yesterday. Everybody flies, but nobody works except me. I'm here for you to bring you any story. The only story is this story. U.S. hit with record number of COVID-19 cases. And what this means is you're going to get COVID. Everybody is going to get either Delta or Omicron. Omicron is up over a majority of cases now. It'll soon be three quarters. And it's a milder version than Delta, which is good. But it can still kill you if you have any underlying condition or if you're old. So you need your vaccines and you need your booster. I'm not particularly concerned about it because I'm vaccinated and have a booster. There isn't really any scientific debate about this. We lost the feed again. I think the Chinese are doing this morning. Honest to gosh, I do. Yesterday, I got trolled by the official organs of the Chinese government, you know, their state media, because I wrote my last column of the year about the Washington Post, about how evil China is, the Chinese Communist Party, and how they're the real enemy. And sure enough, they're screwing with our system this morning. 1-800-520-1234. Let's talk with Ralph in Denver, Colorado. Good morning, Ralph.
Yeah, good morning, Hugh.
Are you listening to me live?
Yes, live.
What are you doing up this early in Colorado?
I don't know. God woke me up.
Are you listening on the radio or are you listening on the Salem app? You should download the Salem. Well, you should listen to the Salem News Channel app because then you can see me most of the time.
Yeah, I wish I could. I don't have the internet. Or else I would do that, but I go to the library.
That's true.
And check it out that way.
So what's up?
But, what I'm calling about is the Kennedy assassination. I saw Mark Lane and Oliver Stone on TV on the anniversary in 2013 of the Kennedy assassination. And Mark Lane said, if anybody out there knows anything about the Kennedy assassination, the FBI reports are out there. You have to look for them, and they're not in chronological order. When you find them, it's going to be hard to find. So I went to the library and talked to the librarians, and they helped me. We got together, and we got some hits on 1437 with Sidney Whiteside. Now, Sidney Whiteside was young and tough. He had an FBI ID. I thought he was an FBI agent. I was from 5, 6, 7, 8 years old. I saw and heard a lot. He was engaged to my mom. This guy, Sidney Whiteside, he connects to Ray Vernon Whiteside from Pasadena, Texas, who connects straight with LBJ. That's LBJ's college roommate in College Station. It was called the White Star Fraternity. And we're from Baytown, Texas. So everything that happened here happened in Pasadena, Texas, and in Baytown. All the back.
So Ralph, I'm running low on time, so you got to bottom line it for the audience.
Yes, I'm accusing Uncle Leo Tanguma of being part of the Kennedy assassination. I have him on audio and video talking about the Kennedy assassination and when he first became a communist.
So, okay, Ralph is gone. Ralph, thank you. It's Amnesty Day on the Hugh Hewitt Show. Robert in Grand Junction, Colorado. Robert, what do you have to add to today?
Hi, Hugh. Good morning. Happy New Year.
Thank you.
I just want you to know that I'm a Packers fan, and I have a question about Baker. You said earlier this week that he's an accurate passer. Well, one of our local guys around here who's a big Buckeye fan, too. In fact, he goes by the name Buckeye. He says he's not an accurate passer.
Well, look, it depends which Baker are you talking about. Baker with the dislocated left shoulder and a harness, or Baker of 2020? Because if you look at the last 10 games of 2020, he was just rifle sharp. It's this year he's not very sharp because you wear a harness and do anything. I don't even think I do the radio wearing.
Well, that's what he thinks. He doesn't think he's an accurate passer.
You're telling me he's got to go back and look at the second half of 2020, and the deal is the guy plays hurt, and maybe that's not a smart thing. Maybe he should have said Case Keenum till I'm fixed. But kid's a gamer. He's going to be in Cleveland a long time, I hope. Hey, Robert, thank you, friend. John in Washington, D.C. John, you should have come to the IEA Wasteland with me.
Yeah, hi, how are you today?
Good.
Hey, first, before anything, I hope that when they consider replacing Chris Wallace on Fox News Sunday, they consider you. I think you would be marvelous in that job.
Well, thank you, but I'm not. All I want to do for the rest of my life is Special Report with Brett Baer. I'm not eager to do a lot of television until the debates come around in 2023, 2024. I'll moderate those. I like my radio show. I like 3 hours a day. I like starting everybody's morning. Television is hard to do. I like Special Report. That's why you've been seeing me on a lot with Brett Baer, most serious TV show in America. It's the one everyone should watch, Special Report. And I'll be doing a lot of that, but I won't be doing other television.
And right now, I'm going to say, by now there should be a tell-all book coming out about the Biden administration. Have you heard anything about who's writing it and what tone it will take, whether it will be sympathetic or very aggressive?
Well, I haven't actually heard of any book about the Biden administration for a simple reason. Nothing has happened other than getting rid of the mad dog. The president was playing on the beach yesterday with the dog, and I thought to myself, that's what he should be doing. I mean, 24/7, 365 is walking on the beach with his dog, because at 79, he's lost a lot of steps. He's lost a lap, and the president is infirm. And I pray for him, but the country's in a world of hurt. Now, Dr. Jill Biden, the First Lady, and Ron Klain are a pretty smart duo. Jake Sullivan, the National Security Advisor, knows what he's doing. Not too confident about Tony Blinken, John Kerry. They got to keep out of the country, as far as I'm concerned, because do the least damage abroad. Lloyd Austin, not too sure about. But I think the White House staff is okay, and we'll get through this. I think Putin's going to invade Ukraine, and President Biden is going to look up from his applesauce talking to him today. There's a Biden-Putin call today, and the evil dictator of Russia is going to take the measure of the President of the United States and say, okay, take it. Go into Ukraine. Let's get that back. That's what I'm afraid is going to happen. Okay, John is gone. Bob in New York. Happy New Year, Bob.
Good morning, Hugh. On your last show of the year, I know I speak for all of your audience when I say thank you. For you and your team and what you do, it's the best radio in America, perhaps the best media as well.
Oh, you're very kind, Robert.
You know it. It's a blessing and a gift to us, and a blessing and a gift to you from God. We're so grateful and happy.
I do feel awfully blessed. God gave me a thorn in my side named Wayne, like the Apostle Paul. But other than that, it's great. I mean, Adam and Ben and Harley and Phil Boyce and Tom Tradup and Ed Atzinger and Dave Santrella and most of the GMs I work with. There are a few who are on the naughty list, but most of them are on the nice list. I'm trying to open my relief factor package, by the way, that I'll use. Here it is. So I'm richly blessed with deep talent and, of course, Dwayne. And Dwayne is my burden, right? It's Sisyphus and Dwayne. Sisyphus had to roll Dwayne up the hill every day. Then you'd know what I work with. But Bob, what else? What other media do you consume?
You know, I work the buffet a little bit. I can't say anything in particular. I struggle with the reruns that many of the media, mainstream media, run every single day. It's the same show.
Now, do you watch Special Report? So the only reason I do Special Report is I think it's a real news show.
I do.
Yeah.
Yeah, I do. I think you're 100% right. Brett is really even-handed. And that's a great quality.
I have no idea how he votes, by the way. I've had dinner with him. I've spent time with him. I've interviewed him many times with his book, the Grant book. And I off channel with Brett. I have no idea if he's left, right, center. All I know is he's really smart and fair. He's like a throwback to Huntley Brinkley days and Walter Cronkite days. I really have no idea. He could turn out to be a completely liberal or a completely conservative voter. And I have no idea because he's a newsman. Isn't that wonderful?
Yeah. Yeah, I think I agree with all the things you said. I think that's a benefit to the audience to not know.
It is. Now, do you agree with me about Dwayne?
Well, we don't want to go too far on.
I don't know about that. Chris Ann isn't anywhere around, and she hadn't done any sharp objects. All right, Robert, thank you. You're kind to say so, and I appreciate that. I really do. I genuinely do. I have my relief factor. I'm back in the IEO wasteland. And that means trudging along the borderlands. I get Western Border Patrol 3 months of the year. I carry an Kirkham and Resveratrol and Omega. Go and take your relieffactor.com. Normally, I would be teaching the next semester. I'm not teaching this year. And I'm taking that off because Irwin's casebook is being updated, and I have to redo everything. And I think all the law is going to change. So I'm going to teach all these students con law, and it's going to change by the time they take the bar in July. That's my hope. That's my view. That's my faith. And so I'm just waiting for it to happen rather than teach bad law. But I do take Icarin, Kirkman, Resveratrol, and Omega every day, and you should too. ReliefFactor.com. The only reason I take it every day for decades is it works. I watch Pat Boone and Larry Elder and people on TV. I don't do TV ads, but I do take Relief Factor every day. Michael Oren from Jerusalem is next.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Job Creators Network.
Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
America, if anybody wants it. But the answer is, yeah, I wish I had thought about ordering 500 million pills 2 months ago before COVID hit here.
But we're nearly 2 years into this pandemic. You're a year into the presidency. Empty shelves and no test kits in some places, 3 days before Christmas when it's so important. Is that good enough?
No, nothing's been good enough. But look where we are. When last Christmas, we're in a situation where we had significantly fewer people vaccinated. Emergency rooms were filled.
Well, Mr. President, yes, I would have to agree with you on that. For once, there's something you and I agree on. Nothing has been good enough.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
Who are you to claim that Fauci is giving this information?
A thinker, a reader, and an honest man with 40 years of reputation of never telling a lie.
Really? So just because you believe something is true, that's still...
No. There are times that I know something is true and I give you evidence for why. I only give you evidence. Okay?
And what's the evidence that he's giving misinformation?
He tells you masks work. Okay? Everyone who studies the issue knows that's a farce. It's a farce.
Can I explain it? Can I explain how it works?
Sure.
Okay, you wear a mask to keep the spittle from landing on other people. Like in the case of 2 weeks ago when I was working at the Army-Navy game, I had 100 people hovering around me for a stupid towel, and none of them could wear a mask, and they all wanted a damn towel. They could at least have been courteous and wear a mask, or at least stay away from me.
Right. Okay. You're an example, okay? And I don't mean to insult you.
Insult me.
I'm not insulting you. I'm just saying you are an example of my new theory, and that is that the afraid hate the non afraid. You're an angry man, correct? You're angry.
I got COVID.
Okay, all right. If you have to call me names, I can't keep it on because it's a family show. I really would. I would have kept you on more. He got COVID. My heart breaks. You're a lucky man. Because if you're healthy and you're 40 years old, as you claim to be, and I believe you, you'll be fine. Okay? You'll be fine. Number of 40-year-olds who are healthy who get COVID who die is so small that you should thank God you got COVID. Now you have natural immunity. You're in my camp, and I'm way older than you, and I'm delighted.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
Welcome back, America. I am grateful at the end of the year for guests who show up most weeks, including Dr. Michael Oren, who is our advance guard in Israel. What time is it in Israel, Dr. Oren?
It is 10 of 2, the same time you talk to me every week.
Well, Happy New Year to you. I would like you to take a look ahead and give us the Michael Oren predictions for 2022.
You know, I always say I'm a historian and I have enough problems predicting the past. I live in the Holy Land, so I can be a little, I can indulge a little prophecy. I think that the Iranian nuclear issue is going to come to a head.
What's that mean? What do you mean come to a head?
Well, either I think the talks will either produce an agreement that Israel can't live with, or the Iranians will go ahead and keep on enriching to 60%, which is equivalent of threshold capacity, and Israel will not be able to live with that. So somewhere along the line, we're coming to a head on the nuclear issue with Iran. I think the COVID issue, I think here it's already beginning to clear up. We're going to be reopening our airport soon, you know, and we're just going to have to live with wave after wave after wave.
Are you going to do a fourth booster? Because I want a fourth booster to roll out in the United States immediately.
Yeah, they started rolling them out. It's not an aggressive campaign just yet because the Omicron numbers are actually, you know, they're increasing, but we found that, you know, that while it's highly contagious, it's not as lethal as the other versions and variants of COVID are. But yeah, I have no problem getting a fourth booster. Well, why not?
Why not? I mean, really, I get a flu shot every year. If I have to get two COVID shots a year, why not? I like being alive.
Yeah, why not? Good. I entirely agree with you. What's going to happen politically here? The government shows no signs of coming apart. It seems to be relatively stable. And, you know, nothing's going to move much on the Palestinian front unless the Biden administration intends to go ahead and try to reopen that American consulate in East Jerusalem, which would be cause a crisis here and cause a crisis in our relationship with Washington.
Now, I'm a little bit worried about our friends, Little Sparta, United Arab Emirates. They are going to cancel the F-35. I think Team Biden has screwed up our best Arab ally relationship. And if they don't get the F-35s and the drones, and I saw some people blaming Israel, which I do not believe to be the case for that.
I don't either.
What's going on there?
I know. It has to do with internal politics in the United States, you know. Kissinger said of Israel that all of our politics are domestic. It's true of every country. It's certainly true of the United States of America.
Yeah, and, okay. Okay, now I have a request.
I hope it goes through.
You know everybody in Israel. You know literally every. I can't walk down the street. I was having breakfast with Michael at the David Ben-Gurion Hotel, and he had to greet like 55 people. We were having drinks. Really, it's like going to dinner with a parade. And so everyone comes by, and they all say hello. So you must know whoever runs the Israeli Tourism Authority, right?
Yes, sure. Okay. I do. Yes.
Yeah, well, I want you to tell them, I want to broadcast from Israel for a month. I think that a goy like me coming to Israel and showing people that you not only can you have a great time, you can broadcast, and it's perfectly safe would be good for tourism. But, of course, they have to subsidize Salem sending me there. I don't want to make any money out of it. I just want them to pay Salem to bring me there so Salem doesn't complain. What do you think?
I think it's great. Not to mention I don't know if it's a competitor, but Dennis Prager broadcast here for a month.
I know that. Wait, we don't ever mention his show on this. Prager is. Right, I'm his life coach. Did you know that?
They do it. And a lot of people have been here. Mark Levine's been here broadcasting.
Yeah, they bring all the Jews, and I said, no, bring a Catholic, evangelical Presbyterian. We're the tourists.
When our skies open up, I will run with that football.
All right, great.
Now the other thing, resolution for 2022.
About Dennis Prager, can we talk for a moment about Dennis? I am Dennis's life coach, and he has a new book called out The Rational Passover Haggadah. Now, I think that sounds like the worst name book in history, but I'm interested in it. What do you think?
It sounds good to me because, you know, I don't know what's irrational about the Haggadah.
That's exactly, right? It's redundant.
The children of Israel left Egypt. They went to freedom. Okay, that's not such a wild tale as far as I know, but okay, you know. We all love Dennis. So we'll see what he wrote.
When's your next book come out?
My next book is coming out probably in 2022. It's a novel. It's right now tentatively called Fourth Cliff. It's a murder mystery set on a Massachusetts island, 1944-1945, involving a police woman. That sounds redundant, a female police woman, who has to find a serial killer who's knocking off Italian prisoners of war.
Oh, well, that's interesting.
Oh.
That's a movie. I like that. That's like the summer of 42 meets World War II movie.
Mayor of Easton.
Yeah.
Yeah, Mayor of Easton. So I'm editing it now. It'll be coming out.
Last question. We have a minute. How many Chinese are in Israel, and does Israel view them with the alarm that they need to be viewed with?
There are many thousands of Chinese laborers here. Israel actually always wants more. They're building our two ports, or rebuilding our two ports. They're building a subway right across from where I'm talking to you. Many construction sites are, you know, emblazoned with Chinese. And in the morning, it looks like Shanghai here, everyone on bicycles and hard hats.
You know, they're planting listening devices in your subway.
Yeah, and that's what Americans. I have sat through meetings both in the Obama administration, the Trump administration, and now the Biden administration, going way back, where America has told us, you know, unequivocally, that if we have this type of relationship with the Chinese, it's going to have a price to pay with the United States of America, and we have to, you know, thread that needle.
Let's talk about that in the new year. Happy New Year, Michael Oren. You're a valued and wonderful friend of the show. Have a great 2022. I'll be right back, America. Hour number two on Caller to Amnesty Day. Anybody can call on the Hugh Hewitt Show today. Stay tuned.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show brought to you by Sierra Pacific Mortgage. For more info, call 888-888-1172.
Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
If you're Anthony Blinken, if you're Tony Blinken, and you're like a frustrated pop musician who wound up somehow as Secretary of State, and you've never achieved anything in your life, the one thing that you can do, the one way you can exert power, how? Killing people. You're the Secretary of State. You can force a war. No, I'm saying this is how they think. Okay, so
it's like a big coping mechanism, or it's like
these. Look, one of the basic desires, as you noted, is to exert power over your environment. Hey, world, I was here. You know, my life meant something. So in order to signal that, you know, you wave your arms, you exert power over something. Like, I can drink this Pellegrino. Like, I am a man. I am not an animal. I am a man. So the higher up you go, the greater the desire is. And that's why they're there in the first place, to exert power. So people go into journalism to exert power. The more overriding your desire is, and I would say most of the time, it's because you're compensating for this deep emptiness within. You have a barren personal life. You're not actually deriving fulfillment at home. Your kids don't love you. Your wife has contempt for you. So you go to work and you're like, well, damn, you know, like, what can I add?
Invade Iran.
I'm not joking. I'm not joking.
I've lived my whole
life around these people. Like, you look around, you're like, oh, wow, that person has a really sad personal life. Oh, so does that one. Oh, there's Mitch McConnell. That's the saddest of all. And or whatever, you know, all these people. And then it approaches like 90% of our political leaders have these sad, barren personal lives. You're like, what are the odds of that? Maybe they're compensating for what they don't have by exerting power over other people. Oh, now I'm very much a sub-genius. So it took me decades to figure this out. But once I did, it explained pretty much everything.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
Seminary?
Madre, padre, ¿quién está listo para ser transformado por el poder de su palabra?
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Schools are lining up to push the transgender agenda on kids and cut parents out of the equation.
Go to salemnow.com.
Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
America, if anybody wants. But the answer is, yeah, I wish I had thought about ordering 500 million pills 2 months ago before COVID hit here.
But we're nearly 2 years into this pandemic. You're a year into the presidency.
empty shelves and no test kits in some places 3 days before Christmas when it's so important. Is that good enough?
No, nothing's been good enough. But look, look where we are. When last Christmas we were in a situation where we had significantly fewer people vaccinated, emergency rooms were filled.
Well, Mr. President, yes, I would have to agree with you on that. For once, there's something you and I agree on. Nothing has been good enough.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
Who are you to claim that Fauci is giving this information?
A thinker, a reader, and an honest man with 40 years of reputation of never telling a lie.
Really? So just because you believe something is true, that's still...
No, there are times that I know something is true and I give you evidence for why. I only give you evidence. Okay?
And what's the evidence that he's giving misinformation?
He tells you masks work. Okay? Everyone who studies the issue knows that's a farce.
Can I explain it? Can I explain how it works?
Sure.
Okay, you wear a mask to keep the spittle from landing on other people. Like in the case of 2 weeks ago when I was working at the Army-Navy game, I had 100 people hovering around me for a stupid towel, and none of them could wear a mask, and they all wanted a damn towel. They could at least have been courteous and wear a mask, or at least stay away from me.
Right. Okay, you're an example, okay? And I don't mean to insult you.
Insult me.
I'm not insulting you. I'm just saying you are an example of my new theory, and that is that the afraid hate the non-afraid. You're an angry man, correct? You're angry.
I got COVID.
All right. If you have to call me names, I can't keep it on because it's a family show. I really would. I would have kept you on more. He got COVID. My heart breaks. You're a lucky man. Because if you're healthy and you're 40 years old, as you claim to be, and I believe you, you'll be fine. Okay? You'll be fine. Number of 40-year-olds who are healthy who get COVID who die is so small that you should thank God you got COVID. Now you have natural immunity. You're in my camp, and I'm way older than you, and I'm delighted.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
The Democratic Party somehow has convinced black people that they're the good guys. Never mind the skanky history of the Democratic Party. That was a party of slavery.
He said, listen, I gotta give these niggas enough. Not too much, but enough that I have them voting Democrat for the next 200 years.
The race grievance industry would have you believe that blacks get up and think about nothing else except race.
If I tell you this is racist, yeah. I'm going to get you emotional.
There is a whole big cottage industry for racism. If racism went away, a lot of people would be unemployed.
The mob during the Minneapolis riots following the death of George Floyd. A bunch of white thugs, frankly, burning down the city's traditional black and Asian business district.
They're racist, 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 racist. Everything's racist.
It's the devil!
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
How 1 million children were placed with local foster families. Parents from all walks of life share their stories of overcoming the one-child policy by taking in orphans.
Go to salemnow.com.
This is Carol Platt-Liebau for townhall.com. China has built the largest DNA database in the world, and it's only growing. This should concern all of us. That's because China could use this information in the future, perhaps, for example, to build bioweapons targeting specific ethnic groups. Given this background, common sense dictates that Americans shouldn't be storing their DNA or other personal information with Chinese-linked firms. Quite sensibly, after getting an FBI briefing about the firm's connections to China, the Los Angeles County Sheriff notified the county that his office wouldn't work with Fulgent. That's the genetics firm LA County hired for mandatory COVID testing and registration. Fulgent even admits in a public disclaimer it stores information outside the United States, where data privacy protections may not be as secure. I'll bet. What's alarming is how many others have chosen to work with Fulgent. The question is why.
Publicpolicy.pepperdine.edu.
morning, America. Bonjour. Hi, Canada. Hugh Hewitt live from the IEL Waste, which is the western border of the Hugh Hewitt Show. I have withdrawn to winter quarters out of the Beltway, but I'm happy to be with you every morning, and I'll get you to work every single day. Now, not many of you are going to work today. Nevertheless, I do want to bring you the update on the markets, because even though, look, the week between Christmas and New Year's, you never make any financial decisions based on that except driven by taxes. Charlie Dombeck of Key City Capital will be along later to suggest maybe some tax planning at the end of the year. Key City Capital, a great sponsor of the show. However, I do want to check what the markets did yesterday, brought to you by AndrewandTodd.com. Never a bad time to buy real estate, never. I never made a real estate purchase in my 65 years that I didn't think was a good one. I've sold some of them over the years as I was a young married, and you have to sell your house to buy a house. But I always think that buying a house is the best investment anyone can do in America, where the rule of law is the rule of law, and over 30 years you pay it off. 15 if you're particularly frugal and smart, and don't live in debt. I mean, that's the end of my economics lesson. Yesterday, the Dow went up 90 points, the S&P went up 6, and the NASDAQ was off 15. That's the AndrewandTodd.com market report. I do notice that yesterday, the 10-year Treasury took a full tenth of a point jump up to 1.543%. Now, that doesn't mean that interest rates are above 3% necessarily on a 30-year loan, but it means they'll be there soon, depending on your credit, depending on how much you have to put down, whether you're a veteran, in which case you want to put anything down, or a senior citizen, you just want to get money out of your house. It is a great, great bet to go to AndrewandTodd.com, answer a couple of questions, and get started. They are working this week, unlike a lot of people where the phone just rings and rings and rings and goes to voicemail. Now, it's early out in their West Coast office, but you can leave a message. They'll call you right back, or you can go online to AndrewandTodd.com, answer a couple of questions. They'll come right back at you, and they will tell you what it is you need to get a loan. And they will help you refinance and lower your monthly payment or get cash out of your house. Maybe you think you're going to rebuild this year or expand. Good luck with that. finding people to work on people's houses. I was talking about this yesterday with my sister-in-law, who's eagerly awaiting an improvement to be done to move to new digs. And I said, don't count on that anytime soon. The guys and gals out there who are working on houses are just overwhelmed with requests, because a lot of people are doing that. But if you want the cash to do that and to get going, AndrewandTodd.com. I mentioned Key City Capital. Head over there, keycitycapital.com/you. If you want to get good advice on taxes, good advice on investment, good advice on long-term, stable, fixed income returns via investments in apartment complexes, limited funds with return of capital at the end. They've done very well over the years. Past performance is no promise of future results, and not an offer to buy securities, et cetera. All the disclosures that the SEC requires. But I think the guys at keycitycapital.com are very, very trustworthy. Charlie will be along a little bit later. And let me also remind you, as you do your year-end giving today, two things to remember. Year-end giving. God gave you five fingers to remember. Number one, you give to a church, your own church. Some people believe there's an obligation to tithe. Some people just believe there's an obligation to support it. Either way, you give to your church. And you should belong to one. Make it your New Year's resolution to find a congregation and join it. We had a couple of churches collapse on us on the western boundary in the IO Waste because of various splits way above the pew-going people. But we found it a great new one, great new Presbyterian church, which we've joined out here. We have a great Presbyterian church in California. My Catholic churches on both coasts are terrific. And you need one. We've got four, but you need one. Then you give to a parachurch ministry. I used to always talk about Young Life, but I love Prison Fellowship, and I love Food for the Poor. Prison Fellowship, you folks have been so generous for the Angel Tree campaign. We got gifts to so many kids. But remember that the men and women in jail need ministry too. And that's what Prison Fellowship does. The late, great Chuck Colson, who's a friend of mine, he devoted his life after prison to bringing the gospel into Prison Fellowship. And they take care of the children of prisoners as well. We left up that banner. It says Angel Tree, but it's really Prison Fellowship. You can make a donation, a year-end donation, and you'll be rendering the service to the imprisoned that Christ commands to you in Scripture. Feed the poor, clothe the naked, visit the widow and the orphan, take care of them, and visit the prisoner. And you do that via prison fellowship. The easiest way to give is there. So church, parachurch. Number three, a military group. Like, I think Semper Fi Fund is great. Number four, give some money to an educational institution. I always give money to John F. Kennedy High School sometime during the year. Harvard does not need my money. The University of Michigan Law School does not need my money. And both of them are engaged in, I believe, unconstitutional discrimination based on race. But John F. Kennedy High School continues to turn out great young men and women, ready for the world, great Catholic education in Warren, Ohio. And then finally, do not forget, an institution of learning that is not one of yours, just somebody doing it well, and that's where Hillsdale comes in. And if you haven't given $10 to Hillsdale or $10 million, do it today. Go over to hillsdale.edu and say, you know, Hewitt reminded me, I've got to give money to Hillsdale because they are the lantern of the North and they burn brightly inside the Beltway and they send their video court. And they don't pay me to say that. This is not obligatory on my part. I just think the work that they do is the work of saving the Republic long term because they educate the future leaders. And I know so many of them. I'm just so impressed with Hillsdale. And I know that really hard to get in now. It's almost, it is Harvard-like, it's Duke-like. It's, well, you get into USC. I joke. But Hillsdale.edu, they deserve your support. They're changing the country. Back to the phones, Victoria in San Francisco. Good morning, Victoria. Welcome. How are you in the war zone?
Good morning. Can you hear me?
I can.
Thank you. Thank you for taking the call. And indeed, you, war zone.
It is.
I appreciate that you're here on the West Coast. Thank you for your work.
Thank you.
I also want to thank you for speaking the word gospel, which is the good news.
Oh, I work that in every now and then.
Yes, thank you. Also, I want to encourage you to do a little bit more television. I want to keep it very brief about that, but that's how I discovered you on Legacy Media on a panel a couple of years ago. So please do make an occasional appearance so people can discover the great work you do.
Well, thank you. I used to do NBC. I now will do Brett's special report whenever he wants me, but that's about it. You know, I'm 65, and I've been doing this for 31 years, and I got to preserve the voice. I really do. It's not what it used to be. It's not what it used to be. And, you know, as you get older, the energy level can stay up, but the voice just doesn't stay the same. So I want to keep the voice as long as I can.
Well, thank you for being mindful about health and giving everybody kind of a life lesson about mindfulness and meaningfulness.
Get out there and walk, Victoria. Can you walk in your neighborhood in San Francisco, or do you have to worry about getting hit over the head by a crazed zombie lunatic who doesn't, God bless them, doesn't know where they are?
Only recently in my neighborhood have the crazy lunatics. I'm out at the beach. I'm out at the ocean. I'm out in the avenues.
Oh,
so
good.
It's
good.
Pretty peaceful here overall, but the homeless, the crime, I did witness a smash and grab in my neighborhood at the local Walgreens.
You know, I'm telling people, they do not understand California has become essentially lawless in large parts.
Yes.
That's why I call it the IEL wasteland. And if people don't read the Wheel of Time, they don't understand. California is now the IEL wasteland. But Victoria, God go with you and make it a great 2022. Stay healthy. Be aware. Get vaccinated. Get a booster and push on. Let's go to the other coast. Peter in Asheville, North Carolina. Good morning, Peter.
Hey, you. How are you doing?
I'm great. Thank you.
Great. I just wanted to mention a couple things. Your show has led me to so many great sponsors of yours. I discovered TWA.
The Wild Adventure you went?
Oh, yeah, and I do volunteer work for them when they let me.
Oh, Peter, have you done the Young Guns yet? I don't think they have any spaces in 2022 except the Young Guns, which is for people 21 to 35. And I hope if you're listening and you have a son or a son-in-law or a brother or a nephew, that is the greatest gift you can give them, TWA.us.
Oh, yeah, it's a wonderful site, too. I've been there. I tore down the camp one work summer after they were done. It's a wonderful place. It's a wonderful place.
Yeah, it's really a life-changing and wonderful relaxation place to go.
Yeah,
if you're 21 to 35, go sign up at TWA.us.
Yeah, I also I want to mention I did refi with Andrew and Todd. That was a wonderful experience.
Good Christian man.
For the poor, prison fellowship, kids camp, Angel Tree, and I just signed up with Key City Cap. So you guys got a great thing going on. Keep it up.
I only bring Peter people to sponsor this show that I believe and trust in. I really don't. I don't want to sell you anything bad. I use them all. I'm going to use Key City Capital in the new year when the financial planning clock ticks. And I really, really tell my audience, if I'm recommending them, I use them. Stay tuned, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
Charlie Kirk Show.
But, you know, I know a lot of guys who covered Watergate, and they all say everything changed because that's when the Washington Post figured out it could take down a president. Without relitigating Watergate and whether Nixon should have been destroyed by it, that's what happened. The Washington Post unseated the sitting president who had just won a year before in the biggest landslide of American history in 1972.
Only lost one state.
Yeah, and they took him out. So whether he deserved it or not, I mean, again, that's a separate conversation, but that's pretty heady. So one day you're just like some douchey Metro reporter called Carl Bernstein.
Yep.
Who really is like an idiot.
And super like uninteresting.
Well, he's an idiot. Woodward's not an idiot, I would say. It's a whole separate thing there. But Woodward's not dumb. But like Carl Bernstein's like dumb. I worked for him briefly. I can vouch for that. But he's a Metro reporter, like covering Maryland politics, I think. On the Metro desk.
Like lost dogs.
Yeah, at the city council meetings in Silver Spring.
Yeah.
And the next thing you know, like Carl Bernstein is being portrayed by some famous actor, Dustin Hoffman, and he's like, taking down the president.
All the president's
and
men.
He's marrying Nora Ephron, and you're like, wow. That's kind of, you know, you want to exert some power over American society, become a newspaper reporter. Well, that totally changed the profile of newspaper reporters, like forever.
So instead of going to go become a general, they became bureau chiefs of the
100%, yeah. Or you know, worming your way through. I mean, during the New Deal, all these ambitious, in some cases really bad people, wound up in the Roosevelt administration because it was huge, it was growing. And if you were a smart, you know, it was the Depression, you're a smart, ambitious person. Maybe that's a place that you can get your vision of America enacted. You know, I want an interesting life. That's why I went into it. But these people went into it because they wanted to exert power.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
The most powerful organs of the state are not merely corrupt, but that they've been weaponized to go after perceived domestic enemies. And that's very scary.
Our constitutional democracy enshrines the peaceful transfer of power.
We are now all rooting for his success. The peaceful transition of power is one of the hallmarks of our democracy.
We don't live in the United States of America as any of us would like to understand it.
We have a peaceful transition of power process. That's not what happened.
They interviewed General Flynn, and they did it in what was a complete ambush.
I thought it's early enough. Let's just send a couple guys over.
And the audience was, ha, 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 ha. How funny to set up an innocent man.
This is what third world security states do. They spy on their political opponents like this.
This is part of a concerted Russian influence operation.
Russian interference.
They colluded. They were in on it.
He would constantly say, I have seen evidence of collusion.
Until this is released, I can't comment.
I can't go into the particulars.
Russians, I'm not going to be specific.
But he knew he could just say it on TV and then hide behind, well, it's all classified, I can't get into it.
Well, it's classified, you can't see it.
Collusion, you just got to be willing to see it.
New York's Daily News ran this front page, Trump is Hitler.
How could 62 million Americans vote for Hitler? Are 62 million Americans Nazis?
We really almost thought it was a joke. Like, really, you're not going to accept that you lost this election?
Then they see the Russia collusion narrative sitting right there in front of them and say, why don't we just say that he cheated?
It divided the country in ways that people can't imagine. It's inspired massive violence. It's given people who are bad faith actors a license to do whatever they want because they literally feel like they're...
Joined now by the poet laureate of the Hugh Hewitt Show, Tarzana Joe. Hello, Joe.
Hello, Hugh. You know, if last week was the most wonderful time of the year, what does that make this week? As New Year's Eve approaches for each empty resolution, I think it only fitting I should make some restitution for things I vowed and promised with that champagne in my glass by some sort of sad misfortune simply haven't come to pass. I didn't write my novel like that CJ Boxer fella. I'm even more ashamed I didn't manage a novella. I didn't write the lyric that would set the world ablaze. My fifth grade teacher had it right. Lazy's not a phase. I didn't study math again. I can't define congruent. There's no non-native language where I've learned to be more fluent. And though that borrowed treadmill daily from my backyard beckoned, I weigh what I weighed last year on January 2nd. I rooted for the teams that lost, hoping they'd be good again, and tuned into their next game, though I swore I never would again. Another year of thrift, wherein I spent more than I earned, a chapter in my memoir, which I've titled Lessons Learned. So after more than 60 years of musing and confusion, I've narrowed it all down to a remarkable conclusion. I've made one resolution, which I'll keep down to the letter. I promise to do little, but do it just a little better. That's New Year's Resolutions by Tarzana Joe.
That's an excellent way to resolve to end the new year, Joe. It'll be posted at tarzanajoe.com.
It will indeed.
Now, I don't know congruent either. Wasn't Nicolas Cage in that movie?
I'll check IMDb.
Yeah, there are no more Christmas presents to buy, so they can't buy your poetry books, but they could buy...
Well, wait a minute.
You know, they could... That's it. It's a New Year's gift. A year in verse ahead. What could be worse and what could be better? And so head over, if you have a poetry need for 2022, get them in early. Write
That's
to Tarzana
right.
Joe at tarzanajoe@reagan.com. tarzanajoe@reagan.com. Do you have a full larder of requests as the year opens, Joe?
I do have, but that would be a great New Year's resolution. Give the poet more than a week's notice.
Yeah, that is actually important, especially if you're going to be doing a toast at a wedding. Tarzana Joe, Happy New Year to you. Talk to you in 2022.
Very good. Happy New Year.
And Happy New Year to Joe. I've got to tell you, probably the most important news is that the Browns will be in the playoffs if the Bengals lose to the Chiefs, the Ravens lose to the Rams, and the Browns win out. Just if they win the AFC North. And I will be in Cleveland for that playoff game. I told my brother, you're not getting those tickets. I'm coming. And normally I give away the tickets because I don't get to Cleveland very often, but I've got 4 on the 50 on the lake, and I've had those season tickets since 1999 when they came back, and I haven't used them because I made a promise. I'm not coming until they're in a playoff game. They've never had a playoff game. Now, they get that playoff game if they win out and go Chiefs, go Rams this weekend, the Browns win the AFC North, and I'm feeling pretty good because I think Baker's healthy. Let's go to Ohio. Tony, good morning, Tony, on Amnesty Day for callers. How are you, Tony?
Good morning, Hugh.
Hey, good morning.
I'm mad as hell, Hugh.
Well, you're allowed.
Kids in, okay, we've got kids in Lemoore, California. We've got a son-in-law that's about to be deployed for 9 months.
F-18 pilot?
Say it again?
Is he an F-18 pilot or part of the crew?
No, he works on the plane.
Yep.
Our beef is we are constantly having to help those kids with food, with basic necessities. They're barely getting by. How come our government, with housing and everything that they do in Lemoore, and it's probably all over the country, because I saw a thing on TV this week where...
Tony, let me agree with you. The fetching Mrs. Hewitt, who has visited our daughter when they've been deployed... And my daughter is married to an officer, and so they are not in the circumstances of some of the enlisted. They actually use food stamps on base. It's astonishing. Terrible. It's astonishing.
Terrible.
Yeah. There is a 2.4% pay hike in the new budget for January, but I do not believe we are taking care of our young enlisted, especially our young enlisted families, very well.
Unbelievable.
It is, Tony, well said, and I hope the people in D.C. are listening on armed services and appropriations. The idea of American military on food stamps at the base commissary is just, in America in 2021, that's crazy. Tony, God bless your kids. Those deployments are long, 9-month deployment for the F-18 squadrons out of Lemoore. God bless them. Godspeed. I'll be right back, America. Stay tuned.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Job Creators Network.
Morning host in the upstate of South Carolina on 94.5 The Answer, WGTK. It's the one and only Joey Hudson. So it's a bit of the Mike and Joey show. You know, Joey, you end every one of your shows by saying, God's got this, God's in control. Sometimes when you think you have plans and you make plans to celebrate something like Christmas, sometimes God says, nope, I've got a different idea.
Well, and things can change quickly, and you're right. Look, you had no idea a week ago that you're going to be asking me to step in. You'll recall you started texting me Wednesday night saying you had a high fever and you weren't feeling good, and the next morning I'm sitting in my barn, which we expected you to be here in Greenville to finish up the last weekend of Annie, and you were home in quarantine.
It's bizarre because this is happening real rapidly, and in many ways, this is deja vu all over again, as you said earlier. But on the other hand, it feels different this time. It feels like more and more people are getting COVID. Almost everybody that I've heard of has had the same experience that I've had, mild symptoms. So there's two things I think is the big takeaway as we enter Christmas, Joey. Number one, not be conquered by fear, because chances are you're going to have a very mild time of it like I did. And number two, have a plan. You know, don't get caught becoming positive and realizing you have COVID and you don't have anything in place. Because frankly, for me, the first thing I thought of was, how do I get to a Regeneron treatment center, which I did the day after.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
Why are you in prison?
I'm in jail for the events that happened on January 6th. And I don't know how to go into more specifics about that. It was, I do want to say that it was not an insurrection. I know that the media narrative is...
That is correct. Different. It was not an insurrection. That is one of the great lies of American history.
Yes, sir. And I also want to point out that I am in here with Oath Keepers and Proud Boys, and I can promise you they had no plan that day. If you met these guys, you would know that they're not the kinds of guys with a plan.
Well, I don't know if there was one person found with a gun. How do you have an unarmed insurrection?
Yes, sir. And no institutional support. Every single right-wing media personality denounced it. Nobody. It's ridiculous that. But we're tarred as. Racists, extremists, I promise you, we are not racists. I promise you we are not extremists. We sing the national anthem every single night at 9 p.m. with our hands on our hearts.
That my friend, is considered an extremist at the New York Times.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So just so you'll know what an extremist now is defined as by the left, if you sing the national anthem every night, you're an extremist. That's how they would regard you, and a kook. They have contempt for people who love the flag and the country.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Tesla was a genius. His most amazing discoveries thought to be written in a lost journal. Now in the right hands, it could revolutionize the 21st century, but in the wrong hands. Kill him. Kill him.
If you can stop an earthquake, doesn't that mean you could start one too?
That's why that notebook should never fall into the wrong hands.
There's an old brown battered notebook in my office at work. You have to find it, take it, and keep it hidden at all costs. The G20 leaders meeting downtown, they're in danger. In fact, the whole of downtown could be in danger.
If we are to build a superhuman, we must first eliminate those who are flawed.
People are created equally. All of downtown, the high-rises were built on rollers to withstand horizontal shakes. A vertical quake this size could collapse half of downtown.
We have commenced the countdown.
Shall we stop this thing?
Save the universe!
Welcome back, America. Hugh Hewitt. I'm in the western borderlands, the IL wasteland, for the next couple of months. Good to have you with me live. It's the last live show of the year. Tomorrow's Dr. Larry Oren with our annual year-end walk through the history of ideas that we do. Don't forget to check for Hillsdale. They're doing God's work in this country, reminding people that the Declaration of Independence is the apple of gold surrounded by the silver of the Constitution. And they do it once a week. We'll be back with Shakespeare next Friday with Dr. Arne and Dean Smith. Let's go to Norm in Canada. Good morning, Norm. You're on the year-end amnesty day for callers. How are you?
Thank you. I just called. I've been listening to you since Don Arne. You took over Don Arne's spot up here in Canada.
Oh, good.
And I've been listening to you since then, and I've tried calling you. I called you when Rush passed away. And I was pretty emotional. Probably shouldn't have called. But one of the things I wanted to tell you from the bottom of my heart is the reason I listen to you is the same reason I listen to Rush. And that's because I trust you.
Oh, thank you. That's actually the highest compliment.
Yes, you betcha it is.
You betcha. Oh, I love that you said you betcha, Norm.
The only thing a person has in this world, to be honest with you, is their word.
And I take that very seriously. And the people who break that to me, I can forgive them. I never forget it.
Right on.
Yep. Forgiveness is obligatory. Being a dupe is not.
Yeah, that's right. When people say, well, God, Jesus said forgive. I said, he didn't say be a stupid idiot.
No, he said be as wise as, wise as an adder?
That's right. Yep. That's right.
Yeah. Be as wise as a serpent. And as gentle as a dove. Hey, thank you. No, wait, by the way, Norm, I say bonjour, hi, because my son's father-in-law is a Canadian, mother-in-law is a Canadian. They're now American citizens. Because I know I've got northern people above the northern border. I go up to the northern border in the summer. Right now I'm out in the western IEL waste, but I'll be up on the northern border in the summer. So which part of Canada are you in?
I'm on the eastern part. I live just, I can throw a stone across the St. Lawrence and hit the U.S.
No aggressive actions. We do not need a border war. Now, I had a question. Will you guys take back Michigan?
Yeah, no.
No.
Why would they want that?
I know. I was in a jovial mood.
What do they want? The Upers?
I was just thinking maybe they were in a jovial mood. They take back Michigan. Norm, Happy New Year.
I'm a conservative living in Canada.
Oh, so, you poor man.
So I'm a center right, so I don't need any more battles.
All right. Let me go to Michigan. Dan is in Michigan. Good morning, Dan.
Good morning, Hugh. And no, that's a rumor. Canada is not taking Michigan.
I was trying to make that happen. That's been the secret. People don't know what my job was during the Trump year. I was an envoy to Justin Trudeau to try and get him to take back Michigan, but he was a hard sell.
Well, if it's ever been a suspect to go, Gretchen Whitmer and her administration fraudulently or misfeasance or malfeasance gave away $8.5 billion in unemployment benefits that were not legitimate.
You know, I got to tell you, I think that there are candidates for worst governor of 2021. Now, Andrew Cuomo won, but the silver medal goes to either Gavin or Gretchen. I'm not sure which, but, you know, Andrew Cuomo won, and then Whitmer and Newsom are in the medal stand.
Yeah.
Hey, buddy, I got to roll, be quick, because I got to get to Detective Tom. What's the point?
If you can. I'm looking on a charity thing, and I was wondering, Wounded Warrior Project and Disabled Vets, I don't know a lot about what percentage goes to the vets.
Okay, let me be clear. I do not want to trash anybody. The two best the two best veterans charities are the Semper Fi and America's Fund. Just go to thefund.org. They have the lowest overhead. And Fisher House. Those are the two best. They have the highest ratings. They are universally admired by the charity watchdog community. I used to regulate the combined federal campaign when I was in the government, and I believe very much in the charity watchdogs, and those two, the fund.org and Fisher House, are the best. They have the lowest overhead. Not that others don't do good work. Travis Mannion does great work. Mary Catherine Hamm loves Travis Mannion. The SEAL Foundation does great work, but if you want the most of your money to go to the Wounded Warriors, that is thefund.org and Fisher House. Thank you, my friend. Hey, Detective Tom, what do you guys do since you don't arrest anyone up there anymore? I was on the special report inveighing against Chase Boudin on Tuesday night.
Yeah, okay, all right. I mean, you know, what do you think? I'm on the road home. I'm drinking at this point.
not on the road home, then.
Well, it's Gatorade, so I think we're all right. But so anyway, what was I going to go ahead and say? So you always ask the wrong question about Baker Mayfield, who is a thoroughly average quarterback. The question you need to ask is how much of the salary cap is he going to tie up if the Cleveland Browns sign him?
Well, first of all,
you're going to give this gift $40 million?
If the rest of the country is lucky, all of it.
Now, here's the deal, Tom. He's under contract for next year for $18 million.
It's his thing for a supper.
Yeah, so he's going to play without a contract next year before they decide to extend him. But what we need to understand is that past performance is no prediction of future performance. And this year, I mean, Tom, you've been in the field how many years?
30.
Okay, so that's in NFL years, that's five. So if we broke your arm and put it in a sling.
Okay, no. Yeah, we're not going down this rabbit hole.
Yeah, no. If we broke it,
I'm tired, and I'm drinking Gatorade, and I don't need to. Yeah, I mean, come on. Baker Mayfield's performance for the first 4 years has spoken for himself. He's a thoroughly average quarterback.
No. The second half of last year, he was a top 10 quarterback.
Wow. I'm telling you, for three drives last year in week 8.
No. Nine games, he was on top of the world. I'm telling you, you know what's going to happen that's going to kill me, Detective Tom? If they don't sign him, he's going to go to Pittsburgh and win world championship after world championship.
Okay, well then with all the extra money, and you keep baying about how great their management is, they're going to use those extra dollars and go get better players.
They are. They've got to get some receivers. I don't think Jarvis Landry's coming back. That's too big of a cap hit. I don't think Jack Conklin's coming back. Hooper's probably gone. We will be, I mean, they should just call up next season because we're going to the Super Bowl. But this run that we're about to begin, you watch and call me in the new year, buddy.
All right, come on. Look, you went on this falderall back in September when we were going to go on this run, quote, end quote.
And we're still on it.
Been going on this roll since 1966.
It's a legend that is unfolding before your eyes. Let me ask you something. Are you old enough that they give you New Year's Eve off?
No, not anymore, because there's so much crime now. They've stripped every division in the Oakland and San Francisco police departments and are putting us all out on the street.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, it is.
When do you get to retire, dude?
That has been brought up in negotiations. Oh. One more thing.
Yeah.
My Utah Utes are going to go ahead.
Poor man.
Overrated. Those overrated pansies who are not going to have anybody playing on their team.
Hey, Dwayne, would you write down that Detective Tom was a Ute fan on December 30th?
No, I'm a Ute fan for the Rose Bowl because I hate the Big Ten.
He's going to forget that on January 2nd. He's going to have forgotten that when he next calls in.
Well, maybe that's all right.
So you think the Utes are going to win?
I took the Utes in the points, so yes.
Okay, I just want that on tape. Clip that for me, Dwayne.
You know what? Go ahead and put me on that Easter Bunny restricted list with the guy from the Canada Warren Commission report. I want to hang out, have an adult beverage with that guy.
What are you doing for the next hour and 15 minutes? You want to co-host?
You want to co-host with this gang?
Oh, by the way, and Dwayne, one thing for you.
Yeah.
All right. My God,
he's got a six shooter out, and he's thinking it's like Quentin Tarantino show.
I
worked for Hewitt for 25 years. You think I'm worried about what you got? Bring it.
Okay, all right. So all I'm saying is he was yammering on about uniforms.
Like I can help that.
No. Let's go ahead and cut you a check for $1,000. We go ahead and set you up and give you a stipend. I mean, kind of looks like the Goodwill box is thrown up on you. And I like
Oh, we all got right, Ben. Look. Merry Christmas. Happy New Year, Tom. You can't top that.
Tom, he left before he said something bad about Adam's mother.
Oh, God. That's the Easter Bunny.
I'm telling you, next year, the last broadcast day of next year, Tom ought to come on and co-host with us.
I got tears in my Easter Bunny list. Christopher in Georgia, top that, buddy.
Hello.
Hey Christopher.
Hi.
Hi.
Hi. I want to...
What do you want, a pacemaker? What's the deal? 1-800-520-1234. We got a show to do here.
Does somebody around you have the paddles?
You're talking to me? Therapeutics are very important.
Yes, yes, they are.
They haven't been researched enough.
Wait, what's important? I'm sorry, I got... Therapeutics, okay, good. Yeah, got it. Roll.
Therapeutics should be supported more.
I'm with you.
Yes.
Researched more.
Yes. Yes.
And there have been therapeutics that they have been successful in using them.
Oh, gosh, yes. Did they have a therapeutic for weepy eyes? Because I got weepy eyes. I got teary eyes.
Have you been sampling too many of the therapeutics?
Christopher, thank you, friend. We're into therapeutics. Greg, 1-800-520-1234 in Kingsport. 1-800-520-1234. It's Amnesty Day. Go ahead, Greg.
Good morning, Hugh.
Good morning.
A couple things I wanted to talk to you about today.
Go right ahead.
First of all, appreciate your show. I'm like most average Americans. I work for the largest chemical company here in the state of Tennessee, and we have been manipulated through this COVID. We've been through masking, and I have my shots. Now we're going into masking again, had schedule changes, blah, blah, blah. I want to know when this administration is going to fall asleep with President Trump and start holding China accountable for what they've done.
Yeah, amen. Amen. Amen.
It ain't going to happen.
It ain't going to happen, but amen, Greg. Thank you for a great call because, amen, they poisoned the world. That's why I got trolled by Chinese state media yesterday because I pointed that out in the Washington Post and, boy, the empire struck back. I don't care about trolls, but they were screwing around with our internets this morning. The Chinese Communist Party. Wow. ReliefFactor.com. Look, I took it in the first hour. Best sponsor in the history of the Hugh Hewitt Show other than Hillsdale. Oh, my gosh. The green screen's not working. Look at that.
Hold it in front of you. There.
There. Okay. ReliefFactor.com. 1995 gets you started, and it is the absolute best natural anti-inflammatory collection out there. I carry in curcumin, resveratrol, and omega. If you've heard me talking about it for years, resolve to try it, all right? Just try it. 1995 gets you started. Jim Talent is next, and we'll reload on Amnesty Day. 1-800-520-1234 is the Hugh Hewitt Show.
This is Carol Platt-Liebau for townhall.com. China has built the largest DNA database in the world, and it's only growing. This should concern all of us. That's because China could use this information in the future, perhaps, for example, to build bioweapons targeting specific ethnic groups. Given this background, common sense dictates that Americans shouldn't be storing their DNA or other personal information with Chinese-linked firms. Quite sensibly, after getting an FBI briefing about the firm's connections to China, the Los Angeles County Sheriff notified the county that his office wouldn't work with Fulgent. That's the genetics firm LA County hired for mandatory COVID testing and registration. Fulgent even admits in a public disclaimer it stores information outside the United States, where data privacy protections may not be as secure. I'll bet. What's alarming is how many others have chosen to work with Fulgent. The question is why.
publicpolicy.pepperdine.edu. Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
You talked about the pandemic being one of fear yesterday, which I thought was very wise. And I wonder, you talk about male-female issues quite a bit. I wonder if you thought that the prevalence of women in media and in government might have something to do with our pandemic of fear.
The prevalence of women in teaching has to do with it. I don't think the CDC and NIH are predominantly a female. Teaching profession is. The disgrace of teachers screwing kids' lives like they did the last year and a half. We're not going to teach. We may get COVID. Sweden never closed its schools for kids under 16. Never.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
As you know, the governor wants kids your age between 5 to 11 to get vaccinated. Have you been vaccinated?
No, not yet.
Mm-hmm. Is your school going to require you to get vaccinated?
I think I might have heard some things about San Juan Unified, which is a district I go to.
Mm-hmm.
It's probably going to require vaccines soon.
I think you're right, and I don't think it matters whether you're at a public school as you are or a private school. I believe that the governor said as soon as the FDA approved the vaccine for children your age, he was going to require it. He's postponed it. It was supposed to go into effect, I think, in January or February, but he's postponed it. But as far as I know, Alton is still going to go into effect. How do you
keep up with what's trending? Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Jim Talent, former senator from Missouri, member of the Bipartisan Policy Center, great friend of the show. Happy New Year, Senator. How are you?
Well, I'm fine. Happy New Year to you
and, so,
and everybody in the show.
Yesterday, I wrote a piece for the Washington Post declaring that the Chinese Communist Party is our greatest menace. And of course, state media came after me with their axes and their trolling. And we've had some DOS stuff this morning. They are out to win, Jim. Do you think the country gets it? Ken Follett, the novelist, finally gets it. Wrote a great book about them.
Yeah, I think there's the last 4 or 5 years. Well, really, I think Trump deserves a lot of credit for this. I mean, he sort of dragged our policy into the 21st century regarding China. We ended engagement with them under Trump, although the roots of this, to be fair, were in the Obama administration's rebalance. And he began energizing, you know, the tools of power and reforming and adjusting them so that we could contest with China over what will probably be a generations-long, you know, struggle, at least one, I would think. So, yeah, I think we understand it, but what I don't think we have is the ongoing consistent commitment from, you know, from leadership in Washington to do what we need to do to protect our interests and our security.
And that would mean more of the AUKUS, more of the U.S., U.K., Australian. And I see that Japan is sending their senior defense minister down to Australia for talks. We got to get Indians in that game. And how publicly does Vietnam get into that game with us?
Well, I don't think you want to do it that publicly with Vietnam. I think you want to do a lot of back-channeling with Vietnam, and we do that. And you're right. If you want to think of, there's two big pieces. One is continuing to strengthen the alliances. And again, the last couple of administrations have done that. I think AUKUS is probably the best thing, right? You might say the only really good thing we've seen out of the Biden administration this year. Now, where we're not succeeding, you, and we've talked about this all year, and we'll talk about it next year, is building up, in particular, the capacity of the armed forces to strengthen short-term deterrence in Indo-PACOM over the Davidson window. We have to do that, and that's going to include substantial yearly increases in the Department of Defense pipeline. Which,
Senator, most important question. Does Team Biden have to come out and say, strategic ambiguity was then, this is now, we will defend Taiwan?
I don't think they have to. I think actions speak louder than words here, you. I think that is one possibility. But if we do what we need to do, if we take the actions we need to take, we probably don't need to do that. If we don't take the actions we need to take, then I don't think doing that is going to deter them, for example, from Taiwan. But yes, it's, you know, I could go either way on that. A lot of experts argue it either way, but we have to back it up. This is, you know, if you want to talk, you can talk softly if you carry a big stick.
You know, a foreign policy giant who you know and I know once told me last year that China would never invade another country. I don't know if that included Taiwan, but do you agree with that? And he put Vietnam down into a category of a one-off bloody their nose, and it bloodied both noses. But do you agree they'll never invade another country but for Taiwan?
Well, I think Taiwan is most likely. But I think if they absorb Taiwan and there are not sufficient costs and consequences imposed, the next thing they're going to be looking at is the Senkakus, which is what, a couple hundred miles from Taiwan? They declare the entire South China Sea, basically, as their territorial waters, and much of the East China Sea. So, no, I don't agree with that assessment, certainly not with the certainty of it.
And then if they got the Senkakus, that would allow them to throttle world trade and actually be the Middle Kingdom dictating terms to everyone.
Yeah, they can do that, really controlling the South China Sea. But at that point, the alliance structure goes and everything goes. Because the Senkakus are Japanese territory. We would be required by treaty and honor and interest to defend.
The key thing there, by treaty. We are obliged to defend the Senkaku by treaty.
Yeah, because it's, and Obama said that. He said, it's part of Japan. We have to defend Japan, from attacks on their sovereign territory. So what they want in regionally is to break up the alliance structure, exclude the United States, control the East and South China Sea, and determine who can move trade and travel through that region.
And they want to do it one bite at a time, which is the only way to eat an elephant, and we have to deny them the first bite.
I think it's an imperative, yeah.
The first bite was actually Hong Kong, wasn't it?
Right, but I mean, Taiwan is a key. I mean, you know, Bridge Colby's written a lot about this. I agree with Bridge about this piece of it, that, I mean, Taiwan is a flashpoint, but but it's difficult to defend. But we need to do everything we can to strengthen short-term deterrence so that we can preserve the peace, protect our interests, and also, you know, avoid this kind of a...
Jim, quick question. UAE looks like they're going to withdraw from the F-35 deal. I think the Bidens have screwed up our closest Arab ally relationship. What do you think?
Yeah, by showing such disrespect to the Abraham Accords. I'm very concerned about that.
That's a glum note. Maybe 2022 will be better. Happy New Year, Jim Talent. Thank you for being a friend of the show, bringing sweet wisdom and reason every week. Don't go anywhere, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt, hour three of the Amnesty Show, the last live broadcast of 2021. Anybody can call 1-800-520-1234. Connection.
Streaming on Salem Now.
¿Cuánto queda?
No queda nada. Que lo siento mucho.
Have you ever thought of going to seminary?
Madre, padre, ¿quién está listo para ser transformado por el poder de su palabra?
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Schools are lining up to push the transgender agenda on kids and cut parents out of the equation.
Go to salemnow.com.
Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
America, if anybody wants it. But the answer is, yeah, I wish I had thought about ordering a half a billion pills 2 months ago before COVID hit here.
But we're nearly 2 years into this pandemic. You're a year into the presidency. Empty shelves and no test kits in some places, 3 days before Christmas when it's so important. Is that good enough?
No, nothing's been good enough. But look, look where we are. When last Christmas we were in a situation where we had significantly fewer people vaccinated, emergency rooms were filled.
Well, Mr. President, yes, I would have to agree with you on that. For once, there's something you and I agree on. Nothing has been good enough.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
Who are you to claim that Fauci is giving this information?
A thinker, a reader, and an honest man with 40 years of reputation of never telling a lie.
Really? So just because you believe something is true, that's still the, that's
no,
still
no. There are times that I know something is true, and I give you evidence for why. I only give you evidence. Okay.
And what's the evidence that he's giving misinformation?
He tells you masks work. Okay. Everyone who studies the issue knows that's a farce. It's a farce.
Can I explain it? Can I explain how it works?
Sure.
Okay. You wear a mask to keep the spittle from landing on other people. Like in the case of 2 weeks ago when I was working at the Army-Navy game, I had 100 people huddled around me for a stupid towel, and none of them could wear a mask, and they all wanted a damn towel. They could at least have been courteous and wear a mask, or at least stay away from me.
Right. Okay, you're an example, okay? And I don't mean to insult you.
Insult me.
I'm not insulting you. I'm just saying you are an example of my new theory, and that is that the afraid hate the non-afraid. You're an angry man, correct? You're angry.
I got COVID.
Okay, all right. If you have to call me names, I can't keep it on because it's a family show. I really would. I would have kept you on more. He got COVID. My heart breaks. You're a lucky man. Because if you're healthy and you're 40 years old, as you claim to be, and I believe you, you'll be fine, okay? You'll be fine. Number of 40-year-olds who are healthy who get COVID who die is so small that you should thank God you got COVID. Now you have natural immunity. You're in my camp, and I'm way older than you, and I'm delighted.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
The Democratic Party somehow has convinced black people that they're the good guys, never mind the skanky history of the Democratic Party. That was a party of slavery.
He said, listen, I gotta give these niggas enough. Not too much, but enough that I have them voting Democrat for the next 200 years.
The race grievance industry would have you believe that blacks get up and think about nothing else except race.
If I tell you this is racist, yeah. I would get you emotional.
There is a whole big cottage industry for racism. If racism went away, a lot of people would be unemployed.
The mob during the Minneapolis riots following the death of George Floyd, a bunch of white thugs, frankly, burning down the city's traditional black and Asian business district.
They're racist, 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 racist. Everything's racist.
It's the devil!
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
How a million children were placed with local foster families. Parents from all walks of life share their stories of overcoming the one-child policy by taking in orphans.
Go to salemnow.com.
This is Carol Platt-Lebow for townhall.com. China has built the largest DNA database in the world, and it's only growing. This should concern all of us. That's because China could use this information in the future, perhaps, for example, to build bioweapons targeting specific ethnic groups. Given this background, common sense dictates that Americans shouldn't be storing their DNA or other personal information with Chinese-linked firms. Quite sensibly, after getting an FBI briefing about the firm's connections to China, the Los Angeles County Sheriff notified the county that his office wouldn't work with Fulgent. That's the genetics firm LA County hired for mandatory COVID testing and registration. Fulgent even admits in a public disclaimer it stores information outside the United States, where data privacy protections may not be as secure. I'll bet. What's alarming is how many others have chosen to work with Fulgent. The question is why.
Publicpolicy.pepperdine.edu. Trending now on The Larry Elder Show.
Fall of science, right? Now, notice when Joe Biden gave a speech yesterday, we didn't concentrate very much on this. He referred to, quote, the former President Trump. I've never heard him say that. He said it respectfully. And he also said, because of the efforts of my and the previous administration, respectfully. He's never done that before. You know what's going on? People are saying, well, it's because Joe Biden realizes that unless you show some respect to Trump and his supporters, more likely to be unvaccinated than my own supporters, they won't get vaccinated. It's not why he's doing it. He's doing it because his poll numbers are in the toilet. He's realized maybe, just maybe, insulting Donald Trump all the time is not the way to win, especially when on virtually every front, Biden is underwater. So now he's trying this. I'll show a little more respect to the other side. Remember the kinds of things I used to say about the vaccine because it was Donald Trump pushing it?
I think it's going to be a very skeptical American public about taking the vaccine, and they should be.
We can't trust the president and take his word and take a vaccine that might cause harm to us.
If and when the vaccine comes, and it's not likely to go through all the tests that needs to be and the trials that are needed to be done.
Let's just say there's a vaccine that is approved and even distributed before the election. Would you get it?
Well, I think that's going to be an issue for all of us.
When we finally do, God willing, get a vaccine, who's going to take the shot? Who's going to take the shot?
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Thank you.
Morning, America. Bonjour. Hi, Canada. Last live hour of 2021. And I will be taking calls from the amnesty list. Anyone can call in today. Let me remind everyone out there that Angel Tree is closing down for the year. You can make your year-end donation at the top of HughHewitt.com. Prison Fellowship operates year-round. Thanks to the thousands of you who stepped up and made Christmas gifts present available, along with a Bible and a note for mom or dad from the Angel Tree Ministry. We did better this year than we've ever done before. The American people are generous. This audience is so generous. Thank you. If you're making year-end donations and you're looking for a really great cause, you can do that at HughHewitt.com, because Prison Fellowship helps prepare men and women to re-enter the world after being incarcerated, helps their families, stays with them year-round. Please be generous over at HughHewitt.com. Just go to the top. They're not doing Christmas presents anymore. Angel Tree is done until next year, or actually next summer when we do Angel Tree camps. But Prison Fellowship operates year-round, and your gift is tax-deductible. Please be generous. Also, I want to remind everyone that AndrewandTodd.com are open today. If you are one of those people out trying to buy a house before year end, and that's smart because you're actually not up against the mob. A lot of people, the numbers on COVID are so overwhelming. 500,000 new cases yesterday, that a lot of people are back inside their houses and waiting for the wave to pass, and that's pretty smart. It would be better to get vaccinated and get a booster. So, you know, venture out to the CVS near you and get your vaccine started. Not too late. No sunk costs. But if you're trying to work online on refinancing or finding a home, that's pretty easy. AndrewandTodd.com keep a list of realtors. If you're doing a reverse mortgage, you're a senior and you've just decided you're not going to live 2021 as close to the budget as you did in 2022. You want to get some equity out of your house. That's a reverse mortgage. Head over to AndrewandTodd.com, 888-888-1172, and they will help you. And finally, if you're a small business and you hate the mandate, that mandate is going to be held in the first week of the hearing on it. It's going to be before the court in the first week of January. And that case is pushed forward by the Job Creators Network. So blockthemandate.com is where you need to go to participate in that. We need members in Job Creators Network. We need you. Small businesses owners from across the United States have lined up by the tens of thousands to join the Job Creators Network. And JCN just does work for you like Block the Mandate lawsuit. Head over to blockthemandate.com and join up with Job Creators Network. They fight good fights. They pick their battles. Alfredo Ortiz, who you hear on the show, is a smart guy. The organization, Bernie Marcus started it, the legendary founder of Home Depot. And they are run by smart people. They do not waste your time or your money. They do not waste your energy. They empower you to be a voice for small business in your local community. Blockthemandate.com. Let me head over to Rob in Louisville. Good morning, Rob. You're on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Hugh, good morning. Big fan, Louisville, Kentucky. I think you've got quite a few fans out this way, too, if I'm not mistaken.
I do, and I love the Louisville Slugger. I love your... the war museum there, it's the best museum of war in the United States, allied with the Imperial War Museum, the Fraser Museum of Arms.
Yes, that's a treasure here locally. Yeah, good point. Hey, I wake up with two people every day, my bride and Hugh Hewitt, so there you go.
Thank you.
Listen, two topics real quick in this order, vaccine and Baker. If you prefer to go to Baker first to get the Band-Aid pulled off quickly, I'm happy to do that.
No, go with vaccine first.
Okay, look, experimental vaccine, first of all. Why do we always call it a vaccine? If the polio vaccine was this good, we'd all have, half of us have polio still. I mean, it's ridiculous, Hugh. It doesn't stop people from getting it. We were sold a bill of goods, 90% efficacy, 95% I remember last year, and I remember that. It's not even half that, first of all. So my question to you, Hugh, is obviously one that's a huge proponent of everybody in the world getting quadruple vaxxed. Help me understand why the need to continually now get vaxxed when we have these...
I will tell you, Rob. I will explain. Now, you know my brother's a PhD toxicologist, and you know that I talk to him all the time about this. And when the vaccines were experimental, they're not experimental anymore. They're fully approved by the FDA now. I believe that is true about all of them. Maybe not be true about AstraZeneca. He told me that the efficacy would be against hospitalization and death, not against getting the virus. And he's right. There are lots
of... they told us a year ago?
No, a year ago.
A year ago?
No, no. A year ago, they thought the efficacy against breakout cases would be greater, but we have had variants since then that have developed, Delta and now Omicron.
Right.
And so the vaccine, like the 1918 flu, is mutating. The good news, the great news, the thank God Almighty news, is that efficacy remains extremely high against hospitalization and death. So if you find people who are dying from COVID, they are almost all unvaccinated. So here's what it does. You may still get it. There are a lot of breakout cases. I expect I will get it at some point. All three of my children who have been vaccinated, all three of them have had breakout cases. All of them were down for 2 days in two cases and for a week in another case, and they never got close to hospitalization. So the vaccine works, and the booster is necessary to keep that efficacy up. That's the whole long and the short of it.
And are you applying that to everyone without any risk stratification, age, weight, health?
No, I think that...
You apply that standard to everybody.
No, I think that... No, I do not apply it to 5 to 12-year-olds. In fact, my daughter, who reads obsessively about this, is reluctant to get her children vaccinated because the CDC will not publish... They've all had COVID. All my grandkids have had COVID. There is no definitive guidance, and they won't even... I hate the CDC, by the way. You know that their communication has been terrible. They will not admit that they do not know how long it should be after a child has had COVID before a child should get vaccinated. So my daughter is being cautious. She's smart. She's not going to get them vaccinated until there is a definitive scientific consensus on when it's efficacious. But when there is, because she believes in science, she will do that. But the CDC, because they are the most inept group of communicators, and because Dr. Fauci is an old and spent force and will not step down because he is vain, is standing in the way of effective communication. But 5 to 12-year-olds, no. But if they have not had COVID, I believe they ought to get vaccinated, as does my daughter. But if they had, I have no idea whether they should, and neither does the CDC.
I know. Hugh, I'm a free market guy like you. I'm the biggest capitalist in the room. We were sold a bill of goods on a from medical companies that have complete immunity. If it came out tomorrow that 17-year-olds with myocarditis were dropping like flies at a disproportionate rate because of the vaccine, there's not a dang thing we could do about it.
By the way, that is true. They do have immunity. That is true. However, it's not a crime because it is not happening and it's not likely to happen. Again, I go back to my PhD talk. Let's go to Baker, but I want to put an underline on this. My PhD toxicologist smart brother says the data is he's taken 7 drugs to market. He's retired now, 2 years out of Big Pharma.
Yep.
7 drugs to market, knows it all. There is no doubt in his mind that people should get this vaccine and the booster. Go ahead, Baker.
Okay, well, we're going to agree to disagree on that one, because if you're young and healthy, you are insane to be getting a vaccine.
We disagree. We disagree, but we can be amicable about it. Let's go to Baker.
What about?
Because you're wrong.
Why would we take a vaccine when we got a pill coming out allegedly again? 90% efficacy? I mean, why would you take a vaccine when you can pop a pill?
Because I do not want to be on a ventilator. I do not want to go to a hospital. I do not want staph infection. I do not want my family to worry. But I want to keep broadcasting sweet reason.
Yeah, but Big Pharma's giving you a pill now. The vaccine's
It's not available yet. And when it's available, there will be a cost-benefit analysis to conduct. But quick, let's get to Baker, man. I've given you segment.
Good. Hey, I look forward to that cost-benefit analysis, because that's the key of everything in life.
Yep.
Okay, anyway, look, Baker, full disclosure, Steeler fan.
Oh!
But we got to look.
Enemy within the walls.
Hugh, I'd trade you straight up for Ben right now. He's a train wreck.
Oh, yes.
Look, here's the deal. Here's what you guys got to do. You got to cut bait. Baker is, like the caller said, average on a good day. The Browns are winning games despite Baker.
You were not watching last year for 9 games. When Baker, before he was hurt, you didn't even watch the first game of the year against the Chiefs when the defense wasn't organized and we scored 35 points. When Baker is healthy, Baker is a killer.
I love you, Hugh, but man, listen, as a football fan, and I'm objective on football.
No, you're not. You're a Steelers fan.
Steelers.
Man,
no,
what, did I, you go I back love... and look at the second half of last year?
You can't. You could look at a lot of things the second half of last year, and you still need to.
He was a football god.
Go look, trade him while he's got some.
No. Baker is the guy. Cleveland loves him. We don't get quarterbacks that we love. We haven't had one since Bernie. He's up there with Bernie, Brian, and Baker. We need quarterbacks to begin with a B. Thank you, Rob. I'll be right back. More calls, America. 1-800-520-1234 on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Watch the new documentary, How the Left is Stealing Your Church. Stream it at salemnow.com or download the mobile app. Salem Now is the antidote for today's cancel culture.
Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
You know, I know a lot of guys who covered Watergate, and they all say everything changed because that's when the Washington Post figured out it could take down a president. Without relitigating Watergate and whether Nixon should have been destroyed by it, that's what happened. The Washington Post unseated the sitting president who had just won a year before in the biggest landslide in American history in 1972.
Only lost one state.
Yeah, and they took him out. So whether he deserved it or not, I mean, again, that's a separate conversation, but that's pretty heady. So one day you're just like some douchey Metro reporter called Carl Bernstein,
yep,
who really is like an idiot
and super like uninteresting.
Well, he's an idiot. Woodward's not an idiot, I would say. It's a whole separate thing there. But Woodward's not dumb. But like Carl Bernstein's like dumb. I worked for him briefly. I can vouch for that. But he's a Metro reporter, like covering Maryland politics, I think, on the Metro desk,
like lost dogs.
Yeah, at the city council meetings in Silver Spring.
Yeah.
And the next thing you know, like Carl Bernstein is being portrayed by some famous actor, Dustin Hoffman, and he's like taking down the president.
All the president's
and
men.
He's
yeah.
marrying Nora Ephron, and you're like, wow, that's kind of, you know, you want to exert some power over American society, become a newspaper reporter. Well, that totally changed the profile of newspaper reporters, like forever.
So instead of going to go become a general, they became bureau chiefs of the
100%.
Washington Post.
Yeah. Or, you know, worming your way through. I mean, during the New Deal, all these ambitious, in some cases really bad people wound up in the Roosevelt administration, because it was huge, it was growing. And if you were a smart, you know, it was the Depression, you were a smart, ambitious person, maybe that's a place that you can get your vision of America enacted. You know, I want an interesting life. That's why I went into it. But these people went into it because they wanted to exert power.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
The most powerful organs of the state are not merely corrupt, but that they've been weaponized to go after perceived domestic enemies. And that's very scary.
Our constitutional democracy enshrines the peaceful transfer of power.
We are now all rooting for his success. The peaceful transition of power is one of the hallmarks of our democracy.
We don't live in the United States of America as any of us would like to understand it.
We have a peaceful transition of power process. That's not what happened.
They interviewed General Flynn, and they did it in what was a complete ambush.
I thought it's early enough, let's just send a couple guys over.
And the audience was, ha, 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 ha. How funny to set up an innocent man.
This is what third world security states do. They spy on their political opponents like this.
This is part of a concerted Russian influence operation.
Russian interference.
They colluded. They were in on it.
He would constantly say, I have seen evidence of collusion.
Until this is released, I can't comment.
I can't go into the particulars.
Russians, I'm not going to be specific.
He knew he could just say it on TV and then hide behind, well, it's all classified. I can't get into it.
Well, it's classified. You can't see it.
Collusion. You just got to be willing to see it.
New York's Daily News ran this front page, Trump is Hitler.
How could 62 million Americans vote for Hitler? Are 62 million Americans Nazis?
We really almost thought it was a joke. Like, really, you're not gonna accept that you lost this election?
Then they see the Russia collusion narrative sitting right there in front of them and say, why don't we just say that he cheated?
It divided the country.
Trump campaign four is what they themselves were doing.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. 1-800-520-1234. Let's grab some quick calls here. Tom in Ohio. Hey, Tom. You're on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Hello, Hugh. Very good to talk to you. I'm a season ticket holder also for the Cleveland Browns, so it's always good to talk to a fellow.
We're in the hunt. We're still in the hunt. We're in the hunt.
Yeah, we're still in the hunt. You know, if the final game of the season, Cincinnati, is winning, you're in, I'll definitely be going. But if not, I'll probably try and sell that ticket. Honestly.
Yeah, it'll be tough to give that one away if we're not in. Yeah.
Right. And, you know, the whole Baker thing, I know you're a supporter and all that, but a lot of people in Cleveland are souring on him. Everybody thinks that who should have been the number one pick in that draft is playing up in Buffalo right now. You know, can you picture?
You know, nobody at the time. The alternative to Baker wasn't Josh Arnold; it was Sam Darnold.
No. Well, I personally didn't want him.
Remember, Josh Rosen. You know, my friend Bob France always wanted Sam Darnold, and I kept saying no Baker. Right. And I still believe I am long on Mayfield, long on him. How many years you held those tickets, Tom?
Since they came back,
you and me both.
Yeah, we switched locations, that's all.
And so did I.
Moved from 514 to section 317A, so we're right underneath the Bud Light sign if you ever...
Oh, yeah. Well, I am up on the 50 under the overhang on the lakeside. There are three rows under the overhang, and I picked those because some days it can be pretty nasty up there.
Yeah. Yeah, those are good seats also. You got good ones. Yeah. Hey, on the political side, I just had a quick question. You're more schooled on this than I am. I had an epiphany of a ticket in 2024. And if Trump runs again, I'll support him. But I'm not sure he can win again. Ron DeSantis, Tulsi Gabbard. Just, it came to me, and I was like, man, this could be a unifying ticket for the country.
Hey, Tom.
The only thing is, I don't know how it works with...
Tulsi's not stable.
Democrat. I mean, would you have to officially switch parties? Or
no, you can put anyone on a ticket, but Tulsi's not stable. I am writing, by the way, my first column for 2022 is the top tier. If Trump runs, he's going to be the nominee. I don't know how that isn't the case. I hope he doesn't run. I hope he reigns rather than runs, because I don't think he wants to get old in the office the way that Joe Biden has. It's just not pleasant to watch someone getting old. And in real time, it's just awful, and pray for the president. But I think the top tier are Cotton. I'm trying to do this alphabetical. Cotton, Cruz, DeSantis, Pompeo, let me think, who else is in there? I'll look it up. I wrote it yesterday on the plane, and I want to make sure I don't forget anyone. And they are Tim Scott, Rick Scott, and the two who are, Tom Cotton, Ted Cruz, Ron DeSantis, Mike Pompeo, Rick Scott, Tim Scott. They are in the top tier. I think Chris Christie is right below them. There are some other people who might run, and you hear Robert O'Brien's name. Robert's only going to run if there's a brokered convention, and they need to bring Utah in to deliver it for one of his buddies. But Nikki Haley, I just don't think she's there. The vice president, unfortunately, because he's a good man, a good friend, I don't think he has legs in the post-Trump Republican Party. But I think China will emerge. There's going to be a national security election, Tom, and whoever our nominee is, they're going to have a very serious running mate who knows the Chinese communists.
Yeah, they want to take over the world. There's no doubt about that. It's time to wake up about China.
That's it. Hey, Tom, thank you. Steve in Maryland. Hi, Steve. You're on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Hey, Hewitt. I've been listening to you. I stumbled onto your show a couple years ago. Lifelong Republican all my life, but I have to take offense to you, and hopefully you'll take this in the right way. And Merry Christmas, Happy New Year. Number one, you have not given... You say you're center-right. Let me just be straight up with you. There is no more center-right in this country. You're on one side or the other. And Trump made that. And if Trump is not shown the respect, and if Trump does not run, and they don't give respect, and he is upset, and he doesn't endorse anybody, there's no way people are staying in the heat for 2 and 3 days for 40,000 to come see.
Hey Steve, I got a question for you, because we're going to run out of time here and hit a hard break. Did you hear the president, the former president, when he called into the show a couple of months ago?
I sure did.
And so he said there are two or three Republicans he likes. I think it's important to show respect to all former presidents. I do not go with the conspiracy gang on MSNBC. I'm not into hating on Trump. I just don't think he wants to get old in office. I don't think anybody should. That's not disrespectful. I've just been watching this infirmity overtake Joe Biden, and it's just not pleasant to watch. Thank you, my friend. I'll be right back. 1-800 Len Khodorkovsky joins me next, America. Stay tuned.
trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
Morning host in the upstate of South Carolina on 94.5 The Answer, WGTK. It's the one and only Joey Hudson. So it's a bit of the Mike and Joey show. You know, Joey, you end every one of your shows by saying, God's got this, God's in control. Sometimes when you think you have plans and you make plans to celebrate something like Christmas, sometimes God says, nope, I've got a different idea.
Well, and things can change quickly, and you're right. Look, you had no idea a week ago that you're going to be asking me to step in. You'll recall you started texting me Wednesday night saying you had a high fever and you weren't feeling good, and the next morning I'm sitting in my barn, which we expected you to be here in Greenville to finish up the last weekend of Annie, and you were home in quarantine.
It's bizarre because this is happening real rapidly, and in many ways, this is deja vu all over again, as you said earlier. But on the other hand, it feels different this time. It feels like more and more people are getting COVID. Almost everybody that I've heard of has had the same experience that I've had, mild symptoms. So there's two things I think is the big takeaway as we enter Christmas, Joey. Number one, not be conquered by fear, because chances are you're going to have a very mild time of it like I did. And number two, have a plan. You know, don't get caught becoming positive and realizing you have COVID and you don't have anything in place. Because frankly, for me, the first thing I thought of was, how do I get to a Regeneron treatment center, which I did the day after.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
Why are you in prison?
I'm in jail for the events that happened on January 6th. And I don't know how to go into more specifics about that. It was, I do want to say that it was not an insurrection. I know that the media narrative is...
That is correct. Different. It was not an insurrection. That is one of the great lies of American history.
Yes, sir. And I also want to point out that I am in here with Oath Keepers and Proud Boys, and I can promise you they had no plan that day. If you met these guys, you would know that they're not the kinds of guys with a plan.
Well, I don't know if there was one person found with a gun. How do you have an unarmed insurrection?
Yes, sir. And no institutional support. Every single right-wing media personality denounced it. Nobody. It's ridiculous that. But we're tarred as. Racists, extremists, I promise you, we are not racists. I promise you, we are not extremists. We sing the national anthem every single night at 9 p.m. with our hands on our hearts.
That my friend, is considered an extremist at the New York Times.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So just so you'll know what an extremist now is defined as by the left, if you sing the national anthem every night, you're an extremist. That's how they would regard you, and a kook. A kook. They have contempt for people who love the flag and the country.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Tesla was a genius. His most amazing discoveries thought to be written in a lost journal. Now in the right hands, it could revolutionize the 21st century, but in the wrong hands...
If you can stop an earthquake, doesn't that mean you could start one too?
That's why that notebook should never fall into the wrong hands.
There's an old brown battered notebook in my office at work. You have to find it, take it, and keep it.
Total shakes. A vertical quake this size could collapse half of downtown.
We have commenced the countdown.
Shall we stop this thing?
Save the universe!
Yeah.
Welcome back, America. It's Hugh Hewitt. One of the great discoveries of me in 2020 was my next guest, Len Khodorkovsky. Len was sort of the, I'll call him the online brain of the State Department under Secretary Pompeo and Keith Kroc, the undersecretary. And he's become a good friend. And I saw him in the run-up to Christmas at one of the Beltway parties. And Leonard told me a story that I cannot believe. Len Khodorkovsky, welcome back. You can follow him at Message from Len on Twitter, and you should. I have two objectives, Len. I need you to tell me about my dad and my brother's alma mater, Oberlin. I need you to tell me about your new podcast out of the Middle East.
Well, good morning, Hugh, and thanks for having me back. It was so great to see you the other day. And thanks for the name check with President Trump a couple of weeks ago.
Yep, that was fun.
That was great. Got a lot of positive feedback about that. It was a trip. Well, number one, I think my headline this morning here is American college students in Oberlin College in Ohio are being taught by a former Iranian senior regime official complicit in a 1988 massacre. That's no joke.
Let's repeat that slowly, because Oberlin may be well known. It's my father's alma mater, very proud of it. It was the first college to admit blacks and women in the United States. Charles Finney was its great progressive evangelical, I guess, leader in the 19th century. It is a storied institution. My brother went there, played football there. My father went there, but it has gone off the cliff. And when you told me this, I said, thank God Dad is in heaven, or he would actually have a heart attack.
Yeah, many people are perturbed by that. But a former senior Iranian official named Mohammad Jafar Mahalani, who was the Iranian regime's UN ambassador in the 80s, and complicit in a massacre of about 5,000 Iranian dissidents in the late 80s. This is not just me saying it. It's Amnesty International saying it, hardly a right-wing operation. He has been granted tenure at Oberlin College in Ohio, where American students pay upward of $80,000 a year in tuition. Really, I should say their parents pay that. And they're being taught by a guy who is deemed, quote-unquote, the professor of peace, who was complicit in a massacre of in 1980s.
Now, Len, you know, when I was in the government, when you were a child in the Soviet Union, we would find war criminals and deport them. There was a special department, the Department of Justice, to find war criminals from World War II and deport them for justice. How is this man teaching, much less not being sued by every victim of a victim? Because that is possible under the Alien Tort Claims Act in the United States.
Well, many victims and families of victims have brought this up to Oberlin administration. One of these members of the family of victims, her name is Logan Bobergan, reached out to me and alerted me to this incredibly insane situation, and said that she brought this up to the attention of the administration. The president of Oberlin College, named Carmen, I forgot her last name, excuse me, but the president of Oberlin College has basically covered up the complicity of this guy. Carmen Ambar is her name.
I invited President Ambar to be on this show, by the way, and she declined.
I'm not surprised, because when Laudon and I wrote an op-ed about this case, pointing it out, and I tagged Carmen Ambar on Twitter, she promptly blocked me, Laudon, and everybody else who has brought this up to her attention. So
Oberlin has a war criminal on its faculty. What exactly were the circumstances of the massacre in which he is complicit?
This is actually very timely and interesting as well. In 1988, this is shortly after the Iranian regime takeover in Iran, the Islamic Revolution in Iran, which happened in 79. And of course, folks, remember that the Iranian regime was born in the original sin of taking Americans hostage.
Yes.
And this is the same regime that rounded up and executed political dissidents to solidify its power. One of these massacres occurred in the late 80s via something called the Death Commission, actual name, which was co-chaired by none other than Ibrahim Raisi, the current president of the Iranian regime. So this Death Commission sentenced more than 5,000 Iranians to death. It has disappeared, tortured, and committed atrocities on an epic scale. Mohammad Jafar Mahaladi was part of that regime and actively covered up and minimized and spoke on behalf of the actions of that government.
Was he a member of the commission or was he a FLAC?
He was a FLAC. He was not a member of the commission. There were only four chairs. Ibrahim Raisi was one of them. But he was essentially, a guy who was in the United States, comfortably ensconced on, in his penthouse in New York, who was defending what was being done. Not to mention, the guy is an anti-Semite, an anti-Baha'i, bigot on an epic scale. Now, that in and of itself should disqualify him from a tenured position at Oberlin, but it hasn't.
Is there a record, Len? Has Oberlin been presented with a record of his propaganda on behalf of the Death Commission and his other complicities?
Absolutely, and it's been presented by an Amnesty International report about it, which itself named Mahaladi as one of the people complicit in the massacre. So there's no excuse here. In fact, one of our strongest supporters is the Oberlin College student newspaper, which validated the claims, and the students are with us, but the administration wants to play, dumb and not hold this guy accountable.
There's a board of trustees at Oberlin. Has every trustee received a packet of his complicity? You're not saying he pulled the trigger. You're not saying he actually killed anyone. You're saying he helped cover it up and propagandize its consequences away.
That's right. I believe the packet has been sent, but let me just, put it in perspective. Assume this was happening in the 1930s or 40s or just after World War II, and we had a senior Nazi official who was excusing the Holocaust somewhere in the world. Would he get tenure in Oberlin? This is exactly the same insanity that's driving this, which makes no sense. And let me just point out that this is not an isolated case in Oberlin. Princeton.
No, it's not.
Princeton has another senior Iranian official as a tenured professor in its Near East program, who was likewise a senior diplomat, quote unquote, in Germany in the 1990s, under whose watch an assassination took place of four Iranian dissidents. Four Iranian diplomats were bounced out of Germany in the 1990s. This guy had to leave. And as a reward, he got tenure in Princeton. His name is Sayed Hussein Mousavi. So there's a problem in our places of higher learning, which turns a blind eye to these criminals on an epic scale.
I'm talking with Len Khodorkovsky, a veteran of the State Department. Now you can follow him on Twitter at Message from Len. Why do woke faculties, Leonard, in your opinion, put up with killers of the Islamist mullah regime and not with conservatives? I mean, what is wrong? What is wrong with America faculty that they do not raise a hue and cry about Islamist regime-allied killers and propagandists, but they do get concerned about center-right faculty members?
Well, I think you said it there. I think they're threatened by conservatism more than terrorism. That's unfortunate, but the perspective in those bubbles is so skewed that that someone who challenges the wokeness of those institutions is a bigger threat than terrorists. Sanctioned by the American State Department across multiple administrations, not just Republican administrations. So,
I think alumni have to stop giving to Oberlin and Princeton And I think they need to bring resolutions to the Board of Trustees, because you're not going to move the president. She's obviously gone to ground. Len, before we run out of time, we got 2 minutes. I want to know about this new podcast as well.
Well, thanks for that. But one last note on the phone. I would love for Congressman Jordan and Senator Portman and the entire Ohio delegation to hold Oberlin accountable and ask why Ohio parents have to pay exorbitant tuition for their kids to be taught by an international criminal, essentially.
Now, Oberlin's private, but it's still useful to throw a spotlight on a private institution.
Absolutely. Let's have them explain themselves. So about this other project that I'm working on, and thanks for mentioning it, it's called Yalla. And basically, Yalla is a new show that's in Arabic, and it's aimed at an Arabic audience in the Middle East, essentially to advance the idea of everything that's possible as a result of the Abraham Accords. Abraham Accords has been a game changer in the region. The things that are now possible for the Arab public and the next generation of Arab leaders is historic. And one of the things that we'd like to do is open up and provide a voice for the Arab public to understand what's possible, how much is possible, to tap into their hopes and dreams and help them realize those dreams and be the voice for their incredible stories. The Middle East is turning into the most interesting and dynamic neighborhood in the world.
Leonard, your Twitter handle is Message from Len. You got lots of followers. What is the Yalla Twitter handle?
Yalla is at Watch Yalla. Watch, Y-A-L-L-A.
Y-A-L-L-A. Watch, Y-A-L-L-A. Watch Yalla. And Message from Len. Len, Happy New Year to you. I hope you will be back early and often in 2022. And I hope someone in Oberlin is listening this morning and that they realize that they're working for a college that is actually depraved. I think that's a measure of depravity to keep people like that in tenured position. Now, they have freedom of speech, but that doesn't mean consequences ought to be obliterated from the past. I believe in tenure, but I do not believe in hiding war criminals. And I believe that term is justifiably applied. Do you?
Of course. Americans should be held accountable. So should former Iranian regime officials complicit in massacres.
Well said. Len Khodorkovsky, thank you and Happy New Year, my friend. ReliefFactor.com. It is a terrific sponsor of this show. It is a terrific anti-inflammatory made from natural ingredients like carrion and curcumin and resveratrol omega. It is my one-stop shopping center. It's the only supplement I take along with a daily vitamin. And I do it because I carry in curcumin and resveratrol omega. I think I'm going to head down to the absolute border of the IEO wasteland of the western borderlands. I've removed to the west for a few months. Try and get some ocean air into these strained pipes. It always happens at the end of the year. Get sick, get laryngitis. But I will be off until Tuesday, and hopefully they will heal up. And ReliefFactor.com will keep me moving, as it will keep you moving. If you give it should be your New Year's resolution. 1995, give it a 3-week try. That's one New Year's resolution that you can get through. Josh Kraushaar joins me as the last guest of 2021. Don't go anywhere, America. It's Hugh Hewitt.
This is Carol Platt-Liebau for Townhall.com. China has built the largest DNA database in the world, and it's only growing. This should concern all of us. That's because China could use this information in the future, perhaps, for example, to build bioweapons targeting specific ethnic groups. Given this background, common sense dictates that Americans shouldn't be storing their DNA or other personal information with Chinese-linked firms. Quite sensibly, after getting an FBI briefing about the firm's connections to China, the Los Angeles County Sheriff notified the county that his office wouldn't work with Fulgent. That's the genetics firm LA County hired for mandatory COVID testing and registration. Fulgent even admits in a public disclaimer it stores information outside the United States, where data privacy protections may not be as secure. I'll bet. What's alarming is how many others have chosen to work with Fulgent. The question is why.
publicpolicy.pepperdine.edu. Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
You talked about the pandemic being one of fear yesterday, which I thought was very wise. And I wonder, you talk about male-female issues quite a bit. I wonder if you thought that the prevalence of women in media and in government might have something to do with our pandemic of fear.
The prevalence of women in teaching has to do with it. I don't think the CDC and NIH are predominantly a female. Teaching profession is. The disgrace of teachers screwing kids' lives like they did the last year and a half. We're not going to teach. We may get COVID. Sweden never closed its schools for kids under 16. Never.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
As you know, the governor wants kids your age between 5 to 11 to get vaccinated. Have you been vaccinated?
No, not yet.
Mm-hmm. Is your school going to require you to get vaccinated?
I think I might have heard some things about San Juan Unified, which is a district I go to.
Mm-hmm.
It's probably going to require vaccines soon.
I think you're right, and I don't think it matters whether you're at a public school as you are or a private school. I believe that the governor said as soon as the FDA approved the vaccine for children your age, he was going to require it. He's postponed it. It was supposed to go into effect, I think, in January or February, but he's postponed it. But as far as I know, Alton is still going to go into effect.
Welcome back, America. Hugh Hewitt, the last live guest of the last live radio show of 2021 is my friend Josh Kraushaar of the National Journal. Follow him on Twitter at Hotline Josh. Good morning, Josh.
Thanks, Hugh. I'm honored to close out 2021.
You are closing out 2021. Here is my my request, Josh. I'm writing a column for the Post for the first column of 2022, and I've listed the likely Republican candidates who will be out there working the hustings in anticipation of President Trump not running. Now, I think if Trump runs, he gets the nomination. But I think he may not want to grow old in front of people. So my list is thus. Senator, in alphabetical order, Senator Tom Cotton, Senator Ted Cruz, Florida Governor Ron DeSantis, former Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, Florida Senator Rick Scott, and South Carolina Senator Rick Scott. I mean, South Carolina Senator Tim Scott, and Florida Senator Rick Scott. So my question is, I know Chris Christie's going to run regardless. I don't have him in the top tier anymore because I think it's going to be tough for him, given what he said about Trump. But who do you, have I forgotten anyone?
Yeah, so my top tier, and I don't know, I'm not sure if you mentioned Vice President Pence. I would put him in the top tier. I'd put Ron DeSantis in the top tier. I'd put Ted Cruz in the top tier if Trump doesn't run. I actually think Tim Scott is someone to watch. You mentioned him. I'm not sure about Rick Scott, but Tim Scott is someone who I think is worth paying a lot of attention to. Nikki Haley, maybe second tier, but I she's in that space as well. But I think everyone else is sort of going to need to have a moment. I'm a big fan of I think Senator Cotton has really distinguished himself on the conservative side in the Senate, but I'm not sure if he has the political staying power nationally. I think he might position himself as a Secretary of Defense type type candidate if he runs. But
well, you know, sure David Axelrod, who I quote, always said we elect the emotional opposite of the president that we've got. So the austere, intellectual, brainy Cotton, and the same goes for Pompeo and who's our other Ivy Leaguer in there, Ivy League law school person that's in the Ted Cruz. To be very, very smart and on top of your game, acuity-wise, that would be the opposite of Joe Biden.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. I have a sort of an old-school view of politics in that I think you need a charisma still matters. You need to still campaign in New Hampshire. If it's not Trump, New Hampshire, Iowa, you need to have a little skill in retail politics. So, I mean, DeSantis has the national star power. He's going to be really formidable if Trump doesn't run.
I agree with that, but do you think there's a little Scott Walker problem there? You really don't want to be the front runner a year ahead of voting?
Yeah, I mean, it's early, and I think DeSantis has vulnerabilities, too. He's a little bit prickly. Yeah, I mean, which plays well with conservatives, no doubt.
Yep.
We've talked about this on the show. But if you're doing glad handling, if you're talking to voters, shaking hands in Manchester or Nashua, does that translate in those early states? So I think those are questions that the early states still matter. The skills that it takes to do well at retail politics still matter. And I think we've still viewed this in a national lens a little more than the real state by state.
Yeah, Josh, I've known Ron DeSantis a long time. He was not originally prickly, but I believe he has always been a skilled politician. He picked up that a lot of the Republican Party wants combativeness. That goes back to Newt Gingrich in 2012, kind of displayed that our party doesn't like to get slapped around by the media. I mean, they hate it, and they're not going to put up with it anymore.
Yeah, I get it. I've had friendly interviews with Republicans who just attack me because I'm a member of the media, and they're doing it for formative reasons. I mean, I get it. But I also think the unique thing about presidential politics is you still have to go to a town hall in Manchester.
You still have to
meet with 20 voters in Iowa, and that's a different skill set, and it still matters in winning over those Republicans.
You know who's getting huge crowds, and I have this verified, is Pompeo is blowing the doors off of venues in Iowa. I'm kind of surprised by that because he's a foreign policy guy, right? He got some retail politics skill, but he's a foreign policy guy, and shows that there's an appetite in the Republican base that is enormous.
Yeah, I mean, look, Pompeo is starting earlier than almost anyone. He's clearly preparing for a presidential run. You know, yeah, he's a House member, Secretary of State. He has name ID. I think he has a little bit more of a hurdle than some of the other folks. I was talking to a really, really high-level Republican strategist a couple weeks ago, and he made a good point that he said there are three parts of the Republican Party. There's a third of the party that wants someone who's electable, a third of the party who wants someone who's conservative, and a third of the party wants someone who's loyal to Trump, who's kind of a Trump guy. You need to get two of those three. You need to find someone who matches.
That's a good analysis.
Yeah, huh. And he pointed to some. I mean, a lot of the names we just talked about.
Run through those thirds again, Josh. What those thirds are?
Yeah, so electable, kind of like Glenn Youngkin. I mean, that's one third of the voters. Conservative, you know, checks all the boxes ideologically.
Small government, national security, religious freedom. Yep.
Exactly, and then the Trumpy, the people who just want someone who's loyal to Trump. That's another third of the party. And if you can get two of those three, do well on two of those three, that's the ticket to success.
Are you writing that up? That's a good column. I might steal that.
It's coming in the new year.
Okay, I might steal that, Josh. I'll let you go first because it was yours. Happy New Year. Hotline Josh. You ought to be following him on Twitter and reading everything that he writes. Hotline Josh for the National Journal. Happy New Year to Adam and to Ben and to Dwayne and to Harley and to everyone down the line. From Ed Atzinger and Dave Centrella and Phil Boyce and all the GMs and all the Marriott board screeners in Dallas and traffic control. Happy New Year to you all. Talk to you in 2022. Larry Arn tomorrow on the last Hugh Hewitt Show of 2021.